Second patient is asking, yes, for sure, because I got my pneumonia from this hospital. So what does it indicate? This indicates, unfortunately, that in that particular hospital, the infection control precautions were zero or they are very poorly being adhered to. By the end of my presentation, you will be able to understand and know what is the infection control, whose responsibility is infection prevention and control, why infection control is important, the meaning and components of chain of infection, and the elements of standard precaution. I just want to reassure that my voice is coming clearly, my skin is coming clearly to everybody. All right, great. So let us start by what is infection control? The aim of the infection control in healthcare facility is to prevent infection transmission to and from patient, staff, and visitors. So this branch of science, infection prevention and control, it aims towards prevention of infection transmission to and from patients, staff, and visitors. What does it mean by to and from? It means that if, God forbid, you are suffering from some kind of a illness or some kind of a infectious disease, you will not gift this infectious disease or a condition to the patient. Neither you expose yourself by contracting that disease from the patient. For example, if somebody is suffering from corona and he will not take any kind of a precaution, inadvertently that infection will come to you or from the patient to you. Infection prevention and control is the discipline concerned with preventing the health-associated infection, a practical rather than an academic sub-discipline of epidemiology. So infection prevention control, it is a discipline, it is a branch of the epidemiology, and it is more concerning towards the practical aspect rather than an academic sub-discipline. Now, whose responsibility is infection control? When we are talking about the infection control and infection prevention and control, whose responsibility is to carry out the functions of the infection control? Infection prevention control is the responsibility of everybody. By everybody, I mean that it is the responsibility of the doctors, of the nurses, of the technicians, of the housekeeping staff, of the administration staff, as far as the hospital is concerned, whereas it is also the responsibility of the patient, for the visitors, for the family members who are visiting the patients inside the hospital. So infection prevention control, it is everybody's business and it is the responsibility of everyone. I believe that everybody of you have seen this picture during your management or while you are having orientation regarding the COVID. But this picture, it is a very good depiction of whose responsibility is the infection control. If we look at the first men, they carry the high risk of transmission, whether a patient is, God forbid, having a corona or the healthcare worker is having a corona. Both of them are not wearing any mask. They are not practicing good infection control, teaching of universal masking. So they both carry the high risk of contracting the infection. If you see the second one, healthcare worker, it is putting on, healthcare worker, by the way, it is on the right side and the patient is on the left side. So if the healthcare worker is putting on the mask and the patient is not obliging towards the teachings of the infection control, it carries the medium risk. And still there are chances of getting the infection. Now, if you look at the third one, if the patient is putting on the mask, but the healthcare worker, it is not putting on the mask, still it carries the risk of contracting the infection. Now, if both of them, both the patient and the healthcare worker, they are obliging towards, partially obliging towards the universal masking, both carries a low risk of transmission. But if they fully implement, or if they fully agreed upon, or they fully practice the infection control precaution, that is, first of all, the universal masking, as well as the social distancing, it carries the zero risk of transmission. So what this means is that the infection control, it is the responsibility of everybody. It requires the patients to implement or to allow themselves to practice the teachings of the infection control, as well as the healthcare worker to strictly adhere to the infection control teachings or practices. Now, we come to how the infection is transmitted inside the healthcare facility. The transmission of the infectious agent within the healthcare facility requires three elements. If any of these three elements would be missing, there will be no infection transmission. First of all, it requires a source or a reservoir of an infectious agent. First of all, it requires an infectious agent to be there for the transmission. The second one is the susceptible host with the portal of entry. And this host, it is also known as the receptive to the infectious agent. If the host will not be present, the bacteria will be, you know, dancing around. They do not find any host to invade and to cause the disease. And the third one and the most important thing is the mode of transmission of the agent. How that infectious agent will be transmitted to the host, how this infection agent will be leaving the reservoir and getting entry to the host. Together, all these three elements, that is the source, second one is the host, and third one is the mode of transmission, they constitute the chain of infection. As you can see, the chain of infection starts from the infectious agent. That can be viruses, bacteria, fungi, protozoa, whatever infectious agent. Then it moves towards the reservoir. That what is the reservoir of that particular infectious agent, where it lives and multiply. Then it requires a portal of exit from the reservoir. Then it get enter into the host by following the mode of transmission. We will later on discuss in this presentation. Then how the microorganism will get access, how it will enter in the host. And the third one is, the last one are the characteristics of the host. So all of these six elements will constitute the chain of infection. Again, what is the objective of infection prevention and control? The objective, it is to break the chain of infection using several elements in practicing the infection control. Let us discuss the elements of the infection transmission one by one. First of all, we will start by the infectious agent. Before starting the infectious agent, I just wanted to have a brief know about the human microbiome. If we consider the body of a human, we came to know that there are only 25% of the cell are the human cell that constitutes the human body. Rest 75% are either the bacterial cells or they are the fungal cells. So if we see in the blue, in the graph on the right, the pie chart, the blue portion, it constitutes the bacteria. The orange one is the fungal, and the gray one, these are the human cells. So if we look at the human body, we are home to trillions and trillions of the microbes. It does not mean that all of the microbes are the infectious agent. We will name these microbes as the infectious agent when they will cause the disease in the human body, right? The infectious agents are, for example, bacteria, they are protozoa, they are viruses, they are parasitic worms, they are fungi. So all of these infectious agents are known as infectious agent because they make us sick. They cause the disease. They start to invade in our body tissues and cause and manifest themselves as sign and symptoms. And later on, if we take some of the blood investigations, we will be able to isolate them. So the microbes and the infectious agents, we have to distinguish between them, that the microbes are the unicellular organisms that can be residing on our body, in our body without causing any disease. But when, by any way, these infectious agents are able to invade the tissues, are able to manifest in a sign and symptom situation, or they are isolated from the sterile sites like blood, for example, or from any tissues of the body, they are able to cause a disease, then only we will be labeling them as a pathogen or infectious agents. Good. So what are the sources of the infectious agents inside the healthcare facility? We have to think that we are coming inside the hospital to get treated, all right? So what can be the sources of the infectious agent in the healthcare facility? We can divide them into two branches. One is the human source, that is the biological source, and the other one is the inanimate sources. Inanimate sources means non-biological sources, all the sources without life. So the human sources can be patient, it can be the healthcare worker, it can be the family members, it can be the visitors, family members and visitors who are visiting their patients, and the patients who are taking care, who are being taken care by the healthcare worker. All of these are sources of the infectious agent. If we look at the non-biological sources or inanimate sources, the housekeeping services, those of the services which are outside the patient zone, which are outside the area where the patient is physically present, all right? These are the housekeeping services, like, for example, floors, like, for example, walls, like, for example, other high-touch services, like nursing stations, for example. These are the houses of the microorganisms, as well as the healthcare workers or the patient-related surfaces, like, for example, medical equipments, like, for example, chair, table, bed rails, vital monitoring equipments. All of these sources are inanimate sources, but they are able to cause the infection. How they are able to cause the infection, we will discuss later on this chapter, but these are the human sources and the inanimate sources. If we are talking about the human sources, it can be the patient, it can be the healthcare worker, it can be the patient's family members, it can be the visitors. Either they are suffering from the active infection. Active infection means that the patient manifests themselves with certain kind of a symptoms, or they may be asymptomatic or in the incubation period of the infectious disease. Asymptomatic means that they are having the infectious agent, but because of the certain characteristic of that particular person, microorganism is not able to manifest sign and symptom. The incubation period refers to the time when the infection agent will get enter inside your body to the time it manifests itself into symptoms. So that is the time which is known as the incubation period. If you are asymptomatic or the incubation period, by any means, we are not able to get aware that we are harboring or we are carrying some kind of infectious agent. Then we can be transiently or chronically colonized with a pathogenic microorganism. Transiently colonized, or the term carrier, it is being used in the literature in a place of one another. So the carrier, it is again a colonized person. A colonized person is a person, as I told you before, that we are home to a microbiome. We are home to the trillions and trillions of the microorganisms. Some of the microorganisms are present on the surface of our body. They enjoy their lair. They enjoy taking benefit from us. They multiply there, but they do not invade into the tissues. they do not invade into the sites which on which they are allocated. For example, we have certain microorganisms which are present in the GI tract. If they remain in the GI tract, that is the part of their our normal flora. But when they move to the sterile site, for example, when they move to the blood, for example, they cause the infection. So we can be colonized, we can have an active infection, we can be asymptomatic or inside the incubation period. And the endogenous flora, as I explained to you, are the sources of the infection transmission if we talk about the human source. Then we come to the second element of the infection transmission, that is the susceptible host. Host, it can be a baby, it can be an elderly person, it can be anyone who is receptive to the microorganism in which the microorganism gain its entry. Infection, it is the result of a complex interrelation between a host and an infection agent. There is a spectrum of possible outcomes following the exposure to the infectious agent. As I told you in a previous slide, that there can be asymptomatic carriers. The carrier is a person which is having the microorganisms, but it has no, but that particular person has no sign and symptoms, so he's a carrier. On the otherwise, we have one of the patient who has the microorganism, but he's severely ill. So there is a complex interrelation of a host and an infectious agent to cause the disease. And that interrelationship can be termed as, for example, one of the basic or major terminology we can use, it is the immune response of the host. All right, some person, as I told you before, exposed to the pathogenic microorganism, but they never develop a symptom while the other becomes severely ill or even die. Some individuals are prone to becoming transiently or permanently colonized, but they remain asymptomatic. Still other progress from colonization to symptomatic disease, either immediately following the exposure or after a period of asymptomatic colonization. So all of these possibilities, all of these are the results once the infectious agent gains its entry inside the host, it can result in either becoming very ill or becoming colonized or becoming asymptomatic carrier. These are certain elements or certain dignitaries of the host which will result in a disease. For example, those of the patients who are at extreme of age, they are prone to get severely ill as compared to the young patients. Some of the underlying diseases, like for example, diabetes, like for example, any other immunocompromised state, that result in a deterrence or the suppression of our immune system may result in a severity of the symptom as compared to those of the patients which are in having a good state of health. Malignancies and transplant, medications that alter the normal flora, as well as the medication that alter the immune and that result in the immune suppression, surgical procedures and radiation that could result in the breach of the skin. For example, skin, it is one of the most important physical barrier that will not allow the microorganism to get entered in our body. If by surgical procedure and radiation, we manipulated or we breached that physical barrier, the microorganism will get entry into the body. Some of the indwelling devices, like for example, central line, like for example, ventilator, like for example, urinary catheter, any of the indwelling devices, even if, for example, you are inserting the cannula, all right? And if you are breaching the skin, you are letting the microorganisms get enter inside your body. If you will not practice some of the good infection control precautions. Anyways, these are the elements. And lastly, the pathogenicity and virulence factors of the agent. These are the properties that must be present inside the host as well as the infectious agent to cause the disease. By now, we have covered the infectious agents. We have covered the characteristic of the host that constitutes or that result in the infection transmission. The third element is the mode of transmission. Now we have the infectious agent, it left the reservoir, and we have the host in which the microorganism or the infectious agent will enter. Now, how this microorganism will enter inside the host, it constitutes two ways of entrance. And you may find in a different literature, maybe they will name the mode of transmission at more than two or several, but nutshell is that there are two ways of transmission of the infectious agent, either direct or indirect. An infectious agent may be transmitted from its natural reservoir to a susceptible host in different ways. That ways can be broadly categorized or classified as direct transmission or indirect transmission. Now look at the direct transmission. It occurs when the microorganisms are transferred from one infected person to another infected person without a contaminated intermediate object or person. What does it mean? It means that in direct transmission, the microorganism will leave the reservoir and will directly goes to the host. It does not require any intermediate vehicle to transport that microorganism to the host. It will be directly transmitted to the host. What are the examples of it? Bloodborne pathogen, bloodborne or other blood-containing body fluids from a patient directly enters to the caregiver's body through a contact with the mucous membrane. For example, if you are taking care of some patients who are suffering from blood-borne pathogen, like for example, hepatitis B, like for example, HIV, like for example, some kind of a viral hemorrhagic fevers, like for example, hepatitis C viruses, you will not be requiring any intermediate vehicle to transport that virus from the host to you. It will be if the blood comes in direct contact with your mucous membrane, with your breached skin, you have fairly good amount of chances to get the infection. Second one is the mites from scabies infested patient. If, for example, some of the patient is suffering from scabies and the healthcare worker taking care of that particular patient, it's not wearing the proper gloves or he's not taking care of proper hand hygiene, there is a fair amount of chance that the scabies infested mites will be transmitted to you. If the healthcare worker, again, it's responsible or giving a oral care for some patient who is suffering from a herpes simplex virus, it has chances to develop herpetic wet flow on the fingers if he is not wearing a proper personal protective equipment, if he is not wearing the proper gloves, and if he is not doing the proper hand hygiene. So all of these are the example of the direct contact transmission. You are not having an intermediate object that transmit the viruses, bacteria, or any other the infectious agent to you. It is directly transmitted to you. Another classical example you all might be aware of are the droplet spread. Now the droplet spread, it is also a kind that can be safely categorized as a direct transmission. How? That when there is a spray of a large short-ranged aerosols produced by sneezing, coughing, or talking, you have the patient, for example, you have the patient who is suffering from certain kind of a disease, and their disease is transmitted by a droplet route, you do not need an intermediate object to have this infectious agent carry to you. Instead, if the patient coughs, if the patient sneezes, or even when we are talking, we produce certain kind of aerosols. If these aerosols come in contact with your mucous membrane of eyes, nose, mouth, there is a high chances that you will be getting a disease. Droplet spread is classified as direct because transmission by direct spray over a few feet can occur before a droplet falls. Because the droplet, it is more than 5 nanometer, this is a size of a droplet nuclei. If it is more than size of 5, it can be 10, 15, 20. It is heavy, it is fat, it will fall down. Once it fell down, it will carry no rest. But as far as it will be in the air currents, all right, it will not spend a lot of time in the air because it is very heavy, it will fall down. But if it is spread, if it is still present in the air and you inhale it, or it comes in contact with your nose or eyes, mucous membrane, you have a chances to get the infection. Pertussis and the meningococcal infections, they are the classical example of the droplet mode of transmission. Even nowadays, I will give you a very easy example, COVID patients. COVID patients are prone to generate the droplets nuclei, which are more than 5 nanometer, if we are not indulging ourselves in some kind of aerosol generating procedures, all right, like intubation, swabbing, CPR, suctioning. If we do not indulge ourselves into these practices and the patient is more or less stable, he's coughing and sneezing, there are chances that the COVID will be transmitted by the droplet route. All right. So these are the diseases which are spread by the droplet route. Again, summarizing it, those of the diseases which produce the aerosols of more than 5 nanometer, they get transmitted to the patient by the droplet route. Then we come to the indirect contact transmission. In indirect transmission, it involves the transfer of the infectious agent through a contaminated intermediate object or person, right? In the absence of these intermediate object, the infection will not be transmitted to you, all right? In the absence of a point source outbreak, it is difficult to determine how indirect transmission occurs. This line, it is not, fits into this context. But indirect transmission, we have to have an intermediate object. Without that intermediate object, the infection agent will not get entry to the host and will not able to cause a disease, all right? One of the indirect contact transmission, one of the famous example, one of the known example, one of the example which is proven by the evidence-based literature are the hands of the healthcare worker. If the hands of the healthcare worker, we are taking care of the patient, for example, if we are taking care of a patient of Clostridium difficile, if the patient is having a diarrhea, we are providing a nursing care to the patient. After providing a nursing care to the patient, if we will not do a proper hand hygiene by hand washing, and with these dirty hands, if we take care of another patient, there are fair amount of chances that we will be transmitting the infection to the other patient. Hands of the healthcare worker, as I told you, that is one of the most important element in transmitting when we are talking about the indirect transmission. Patient care devices, electronic thermometers, glucose monitoring devices, all the other devices, if we do not perform a quality cleaning and disinfection in between the patient, there are chances that we will receive this infection. Then there are the shared toys in the pediatric hospital, in the MCH or inside the clinics where we take care of the pedia patients, the child patients. The shared toys may become a vehicle of transmitting the respiratory virus, like for example, respiratory syncytial viruses or other pathogenic bacteria, like for example, Pseudomonas aeruginosa. They survive on these kind of environments, and there is a fair amount of chance that if we touch these and then touch these equipments or twice, and then we touch our patient without doing proper hand hygiene, there are chances of getting the infection or giving the infection to the patient. If you are talking about the indirect mode of transmission, there can be three. There is the airborne, there's a vehicle borne, and there is a vector borne. Inside the hospitals, we are only concerned with the airborne mode of transmission. So we have covered direct transmission. Inside the direct transmission, we have covered the contact transmission. Then we are talking about the indirect contact and the droplet transmission. Inside the indirect, we will cover only the airborne route of transmission. In the airborne transmission, the infectious agents are carried by the dust or droplet nuclei that are suspended in air. Now, when we called a droplet nuclei, it is capable of having the airborne transmission when the size of the droplet nuclei will be less than 5 microns. All right. We have studied, we have told you some of the diseases, like for example, meningitis, like for example, COVID patient in a stable condition. If these are the condition, like for example, pertussis, if these are the diseases, they are transmitted by the droplet route. But if we are having a disease which is able to produce the aerosols or the droplet nuclei of less than 5 microns, then this disease will be transmitted by the airborne route. When we will name this as a droplet nuclei spreaded by the airborne route, it is having a size of less than 5 micron. Now the size of less than 5 micron means that it is lightweight, it is smaller in size, it has the ability to remain suspended in the air for a very long time. When we pass through it, the air currents will be formed and it will be transmitted to the different places beyond even the patient room. Like for example, measles, when we have in a clinic, there is a patient of a measles and it is taken care by the physician. If we are not following the infection control precautions properly, we are not properly cleaning and disinfecting the high touch surfaces, the patient area or the zone after the patient leave, and another patient will come, there is a fair amount of chance that the other patient will get measles if the previous patient was suffering from measles and not following the proper precautions. Then we have the airborne dust. Like for example, we have construction and renovation going on in our heat and ventilation system in our hospitals. If after construction and renovation, we would not clean properly the zone, there are chances that we will be getting the infection, that is the fungal infection, which is transmitted by the airborne route. All right. The famous example can be the aspergillosis. All right. If we do not take care after proper construction and renovation, it can result in a very, severe kind of an outbreak, very hard to control type of outbreak and result in a serious consequences. So this is how the airborne transmission occurs, either by the dust or by the droplet nucleus. We will skip this part, vehicle transmission, as well as the vector transmission, because this is are best likely to appear inside the hospitals. All right. So as we discussed before, as we talked before, as we came to know before, that the aim of the infection control is to break the chain of infection, is to break the spread of transmission of the infection. But how the infection control breaks the chain of infection, how the infection control will prevent the spread of the microorganism, how it will happen? It will happen because of the sets of elements which are collectively known as the standard precautions. By utilizing the elements of the standard precautions, we will be able to break the chain of infection. We will be able to cut down the transmission of infection among the healthcare workers to the patient or from patient to the healthcare workers. Standard precautions are the minimum infection prevention practices that apply to all patient care, regardless of suspected or confirmed infectious status of the patient. Like, it, what does it mean? It means that whenever there is any patient inside your facility, you know the status of a patient or you do not know the status of a patient that he or she is suffering from some kind of infectious disease, you have to observe certain elements of the infection control, which are known as standard precaution, regardless of the status of a patient, to break the chain of infection. Another definition by the CDC, by the WHO, is that standard precautions are meant to reduce the risk of transmission of the blood-borne pathogens or the other pathogen from both recognized source or the unrecognized source. So for example, if the patient is having a certain kind of infectious disease or the patient is not having a certain kind of infectious disease, we have to implement or we have to practice the elements of a standard precautions to break the chain of an infection. As we discussed before, the patient is patient. Patient is having a sign and symptom of infectious disease. So everybody, every healthcare worker will be alarmed and they will be, there is a great amount of tendency that they will observe the standards of infection prevention and control. But if the patient is colonized with some kind of infectious agent, if the patient is just an asymptomatic carrier, he is generally fine. He does not manifest any kind of a sign and symptom of that particular disease, but he can transmit the virus or the bacteria or any other infectious agent. If we will not take care of this from this patient, assumingly that he is all right, there is a chance that the infection transmission will occur. So the standard precautions implies on any patient, whether you know the status or you do not know the status of the infectious being. Why the infection, why these standard infection control elements or why the standard precautions are important? These are the eye-opening statements, all right? These are the eye-opening statistics. The European Standard Center of Disease Prevention and Control estimates that 4,131,000 patients are affected by approximately of 4,544,000 episodes of health-related infections every year. So almost 4 million of the patients, they are affected by the 4.5 million episodes of the healthcare-associated infections every year. How we will prevent these infections? By observing the infection control precautions. So that is why standard precautions are important. It is estimated that in the United States, we know the facilities are much better. All of the things are much better, but you know, the staffing ratio presumably will be much better. The equipments, the technologies will be much better. Still there are 4.5% is the incidence rate of healthcare associated infections, corresponding to 9.3 million infections per 1,000 patient days and 1.7 million affected patients. So this is the time to worry, all right? By having such a great numbers in front of us, we have to think upon certain elements. We have to strictly practice some of the elements that will result in breakdown of these numbers, bring them to zero. Thousands of people die every day around the world from the infections which are hospital acquired. The hospital acquired infections can only be prevented by having strict adherence to the infection control precautions. The elements of the infection control precautions, collectively named as the elements of a standard precautions, are 10. They can be, you know, holistically, they are the one plus minus some of the elements which can be embedded in between them. So these 10 elements are the hand hygiene, the personal protective equipments, respiratory and cough etiquettes, occupational exposure, clinical waste, linen management, spill management, environmental cleaning, disinfection, isolation precautions, and the patient care equipments. Now you must be thinking that why the first three are in a separate color and the fourth one are in a separate color and the last six are in a separate color. The reason for that first three, that comes to you. For example, you are the one, if you practice the good hand hygiene in between the patient, before touching the patient, there are the moments of the hand hygiene will be presented by my next expert colleague, personal protective equipments. And if you follow or the patient follow the respiratory and cough etiquettes, there are, it will cut down the chain of infection. It will cut down the transmission of infection. The infection will not come to you if you do the proper hand hygiene. If you put on the personal protective equipments, if you observe the respiratory and cough etiquettes. Occupational exposure, it is also one of the very important factor that that will protect us from contracting or having the disease comes to us. For example, in the occupational exposure, if we are properly vaccinated, if you are properly vaccinated against certain diseases which can be prevented by the vaccine, for example, corona, for example, measles, mumps, rubella, for example, hepatitis B, if we are properly and if we are completely vaccinated by these kind by these vaccinations, there are very less amount of chances that we will able to get a disease. As well as if we practice the safe injection technique in a right way, if we get strict, if we have a good implementation of aseptic procedures in place, there are less chances of contracting the disease. The last six, clinical waste, linen management, spill management, environmental cleaning, disinfection, patient care equipment, and isolation precautions, you will come to know in one slide that why this is important, right? So these are the 10 elements of the infection prevention and control in the standard precaution that will be covered by my expert colleagues in the following lectures. But these are the elements which can, which comprised of the standard precautions. Occupational exposure, now, again, this slides come, okay. The occupational exposure, it is very important because 35.7 million healthcare workers in the world are exposed to the needle stick injuries. As I told you before, that if you practice a safe injection technique, if you are properly vaccinated by a blood-borne, for example, by a blood-borne pathogen, like, for example, hepatitis B, there are very less chances that you will be contracting that disease, all right? Now, look at we will look at these six again, all right? The clinical waste and the linen management, spill management, environmental cleaning and disinfection, patient care equipment, cleaning and disinfection, isolation precaution. Like, for example, we will keep a patient in a single room, in a good ventilated room. We will be performing a terminal cleaning afterwards. But you know, all of these things, why these are important, why so much emphasis on strictly abiding towards good cleaning and disinfection is that a large amount of the bacteria, viruses, fungi, they are able to survive on the surfaces, on the inanimate surfaces, on the non-biological surfaces in the hospital environment for very big time. For example, Acinetobacter, it can live from 3 days to 1 year, all right? 36 days within the biofilms, you will be studying the biofilms. This is inside, this is a kind of a humid, environment for the microorganisms inside the tubes or inside some kind of a pipes, sewage pipe, for example, or inside the indwelling catheters, for example, they form the biofilms. It requires a whole lecture to explain about the biofilms. But you will see the extent that from 3 days to 1 year, it can stay inside on the surface. As soon as it will get its entrance to the host, it will cause the disease. If we will not properly disinfect the surfaces, clean the surfaces, we will be able to get the disease. From 3 6 to 1 years, Clostridium difficile 5 months, Clostridium difficile vegetative form from 15 minutes to 6 hours, and from different type of microorganism, this length varies. One of the most common hospital acquired infection is a result of the last one, that is a methicillin resistant staph aureus and methicillin sensitive staph aureus. It can live up to 72 hours on a stainless steel surfaces, can live up to 6 hours on a surfaces which are having a copper, and even live on almost 28 days to 1 month on certain surfaces. If we talk about the viruses, adenoviruses, SARS viruses, hepatitis A, B, viruses, HIV, herpes simplex, rotaviruses, these viruses live from hours to months, even to several months, if they are not properly cleaned and disinfected by the equipments or by the proper kind of a disinfectants
it will result in the transmission if we touch them and then touch our mucous membranes or touch to the patients. There are high amount of chances that it will come to you. And this is the list of several fungi species that can live on the surfaces from days to even months. What does it mean? That again, last six elements of the standard precautions, if we not utilize proper cleaning and disinfection, we are having a fair amount of chances that we will be getting the infections. I'm repeating it again that these elements will be explained by my expert colleagues in my follow-up lecture. That is all for my lecture. If you have any queries, any questions, you are most welcome to ask. Thank you very much for your patience, and I hope that you got everything, if not everything, at least something from this presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Reyes. Thank you for your presented, excellent present. If anyone have any questions, please write in the chat. إذا عندكم أي أسئلة لو سمحت ممكن تتفضلوا تكتبونها على الشات.
MashaAllah, I'm receiving a lot of thanks.
A lot of thanks without question.
Yeah, sister, there is a saying that if after your lecture there is no question, it means that there is a 0% understanding of your lecture, or everybody understand 100%.
Excellent.
So it will be two extremes, either 0% or 100%. Thank you very much for your patience. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, doctor. بالنسبة للبريد تيست رجاء اللي ما دخل على الرابط يدخل عليه، لأن نهاية اليوم راح نقفل الرابط بإذن الله. الآن عندنا اللي هو second session is hand hygiene present by Mr. نواف المطرفي. Who had a bachelor degree of health science and member of outbreak and RRT teams, member of GDIBC in MOH. Welcome, Nawaf.
Assalamu alaikum. Majlis sawt wadh, Allah yahdik.
It's very fine, brother Nawaf.
واضح جدا نواف. تبي تعمل شير او اسوي لك انا شير؟ اوكي تمام، يعطيك العافيه.
طيب الله يعافيك. السلام عليكم جميعا، اسعد الله مساءكم بكل خير. معاكم نواف المطرفي من الاداره العامه لمكافحه عدم المنشآت الصحيه ديوان الوزاره. اليوم باذن الله بنتكلم عن الهاند هايجين. طبعا جميع الممارسين الصحيين على اطلاع ومعرفه تامه بموضوع الهاند هايجين ومدى أهميته في التعامل مع المرضى ومدى اهتمامنا بهذا الموضوع. في البداية أود أطلعكم على فيديو بسيط يتحدث عن كيفية انتقال العدوى بين الممارسين الصحيين، أو انتقال العدوى من ممارس صحي إلى patient أو من patient to patient. فيا ليت لو تطلعون على الفيديو قبل ما نبدأ المحاضرة. Thank you.
50% من حالات العدوى المكتسبة بالمنشآت الصحية يمكن تجنبها بتطهير اليدين.
طيب الله يعطيكم العافية. عفوا. طيب بداية الله يعطيكم العافية، اطلعتوا على الفيديو. حنا نعرف الآن انتقال العدوى يتم بين الداخل، دائما داخل المنشأة الصحية في حال تم انتقال العدوى بين ممارس صحي أو patient أو من ممارس صحي إلى ممارس صحي أو من ممارس صحي أو من patient to patient، تكون دائما عن طريق الجيرمز اللي حنا ما نكون على اطلاع فيها أو ما نعلم في ما نعلم بوجودها بيننا، حتى ما نعلم إذا كانت موجودة أيضا في الانفايرمنت. فاليوم إن شاء الله بنحاول نغطي الأشياء الأساسية في موضوع تطهير الأيدي. الهاند هايجين، تعريف الهاند هايجين هو is a term for hand washing with soap and water or disinfection of hands by alcohol hand drop materials. هو طبعا عبارة عن إنه عندنا فيه تكنيكين، عبارة عن الهاند هايجين، الهاند واشينج والهاند روبينج. طيب ايش الاشياء اللي نحتاج احنا نعرفها؟ زي ما انتم شايفينها هنا ثلاث عناصر. It's well established that hands of healthcare workers are the principal cause of transmission of infection from patient to patient. هنا يتكلم عن انه السبب الرئيسي او السبب الاساسي في انتقال العدوى من مريض الى مريض. ايضا following contact with patients or contaminated environment germs can survive on hands for diverse length of time من دقيقتين إلى 60 دقيقة. وجودها موجود. In the absence of hand hygiene action, the longer the duration of care, the higher degree of hand contamination. يعني حنا نقول هنا إنه وجود أو عدم عمل الهاند hygiene وفي خلال أدائك داخل المنشأة الصحية أو خلع القفص وعدم عملها بطريقة صحيحة، هذا يكون عندنا نسبة عالية لوجود، يكون عندنا الهاند كونتامينيشن موجود داخل على يدين الممارسين الصحيين. عندنا هذه الفاكتس، في عندنا عناصر رئيسية إنها الهاند هايجين a very simple action remains the primary means to reduce the hospital acquired infections and the spread of antimicrobial resistance organisms. هنا نقول إنه هي عملية بسيطة يعمل الممارس الصحي تطهير الأيدي أو غسيل الأيدي، والنسبة إنها تقلل من الهوسبيتال اكواير انفكشن، تقلل من نسبة العدوى السبريد داخل المنشأة الصحية. أيضا الدراسات الـ Global Research indicates that improvements in hand hygiene activities could potentially reduce hospital acquired infection rate by up to 50%. إيش يدل لنا إذا تم عمل الهاند هايجين؟ يدل لنا إنه حيكون في تقليل لنسبة العدوى بما يقارب أكثر من أو عفوا بما يقارب أكثر من 50%. زي ما قلنا الهاند هايجين most important way to prevent the hospital acquired infection. طيب why should you clean your hands؟ أكيد طبعاً to protect the patient against harmful germs carried on your hands or present on her or his skin on skin. طبعاً إنه حماية للمريض من أي جراثيم تكون موجودة على اليدين، بالإضافة إلى protect yourself and the healthcare environment from harmful germs. طيب عندنا golden rules for hand hygiene. The hand hygiene must be performed exactly where you are delivering healthcare to patient at the point of care. هنا نقول إنه حنا عندنا الهاند هايجين نعمله، ولكن لازم يكون عمله دائما في الأماكن المخصصة. يعني إنه قبل ما أخش في منطقة المريض أو قبل ما أخش في منطقة ال point of care، إني لازم أكون أنا عارف أو على اطلاع إني لازم أنا حتى لو إني عملت الهاند هايجين قبل دخولي، ممكن إني لمست الباب بيدي أو ممكن إني كنت ماسك حاجة جيت حطيتها على الترولي داخل عند المريض، فإني لازم أعمل الهاند هايجين مو على طول ألبس الجلوفز. عندنا during healthcare delivery there are 5 moments as healthcare practitioners you must know the 5 moments وحنجيها إن شاء الله ونتطرق لها في السلايدات القادمة. When is it's essential that you perform hand hygiene, my 5 moments for hand hygiene. Why? ليش حنا نعملها؟ Because it makes hand hygiene possible right at the point of care. It's faster, سريعة, more effective and better tolerated. طيب عندنا هنا a definition of point of care refer to the place where 3 elements occur together. أيضا عندنا the concept, الفكرة إنها الاحتياجات the need to perform hand hygiene at recommended moments exactly where care delivery take place. What is it required? This requires that hand hygiene product, alcohol-based hand rub, if available, be easily accessible as close as possible within arm's reach. طبعا ايضا where patient care or treatment is taking place. زي ما انتم شايفين هنا في الـ pictures ان هذه تتكلم عن المريض, تتكلم عن مكان المريض, تتكلم عن السراوندينج وموقع المريض بنفس الشيء. عندنا هنا زي ما انتم شايفين الـ point of care وين توضع هي الهاند العلب الكحول الجل الكحولي, تعمل على اللي هي الحائط, تعمل تكون قريبة من منطقة المريض, تكون معلقة على بعض الأجهزة, تكون أيضا على البيتريل, تكون أيضا في البوكلت, تكون أيضا على الترولي, تكون في الحائط زي ما انتم شايفين في الصور, كلها في البيشنت زون. طيب نجي لل 5 moments of hand hygiene. دائما لازم نعرف ان عندنا 2 before, حاجتين قبل, و 3 after, 3 بعد. ايش عندنا قبل؟ before touching patient, قبل ملامسه المريض, before cleaning aseptic procedure, قبل اللي هي التحضير او قبل تنظيف ادوات. عندنا ايضا 3 after, after body fluid exposure, بعد ما تعامل مع المريض. عندنا after touching the patient, عندنا ايضا after touching the patient surrounding, المنطقه المحيطه المريض. هنا نجي لل before patient contact. ليش؟ لانه احنا helping a patient to move around, get washed, giving massage or physiotherapy. احنا نتعامل مع المريض دائما, اكيد بيكون في تلامس بين الممارس الصحي والمريض, فلذلك انه لازم تكون عاملها قبل ملامسة المريض. عندك stroking a child's forehead وstroking an arm or shaking hands, وموضحة كمان أيضا بالصور. أيضا taking pulse, blood pressure, chest auscultation, عندنا abdominal palpation. Before aseptic task, ليش؟ لأنه عندنا skin leisure care, الون دريسنج, الدريسنج سيتس, والبريبريشن اوف ميديكيشنز. دائما لازم يتم عمل الهاند هايجين قبل استخدامها. افتر بودي فلويد اكسبوجر, عندنا الاورال دنتال كير, البرشنج ذا بيشنتس تيث, جيفينج اي دروبس, سكن ليجر كير, الون دريسنج, كليننج اب اليورين, فوميتنج, والهاندلنج للويست. موضح ايضا بالصور. عندنا after touch, after patient contact, shaking hands, stroking an arm, نفس المرحله اللي هي ما قبل ملامسه المريض. عندنا ايضا helping a patient to move around في حال التعامل مع elderly ages, and get washed, blood pressure, and also applying oxygen mask. After contact with patient surrounding, لان دائما احنا نعمل changing the bed, linen with the patient out of the bed, monitoring alarm, holding a bed rail, clearing the bedside table. دائما احنا نتعامل مع البيشنت زون انها منطقه surrounding, منطقه محيطه له, ففي بعد الانتهاء دائما لازم يتم عمل الهاند هايجين. الهاند هايجين طبعا الهاند واشنج والانتيسبتيك هاند واش والانتيسبتيك هاند روبينج والسيرجيكال هاند سكروبينج. نجي الـ use of alcohol based hand rub is the preferred means for routine hand hygiene. providing hands are not visibly soiled with blood or body fluid. عندنا ليش حنا دائما نسوي الهاند هايجين؟ عندنا do we use hand rub all the time أو إننا نعمل الهاند ووش؟ الهاند رب والهاند ووش عندنا. عندنا الهاند we should perform through hand wash using soap and water. عندنا خمسة أشياء لازم نعمل بعدها الهاند ووش، اللي هي whenever hands are visibly dirty، عندما تكون اليد واضحة أنها متسخة. Whenever they are visibly soiled with blood or other body fluids، عندما تكون مرطخة بالدماء. عندنا after suspected exposure to potential spore-forming pathogens. عندنا أيضا if hands are visibly clean but an alcohol-based hand rub is not available، عندما ما يكون موجود أو متوفر يعمل لها. عندنا after using the toilet الwashroom لازم إنه يتم عمل الhand wash. طبعا عندنا الhand wash والhand rub، الhand wash يتم عمله من 40 إلى 60 ثانية، الhand rub يتم عمله من 20 إلى 30 ثانية. هنا عندنا في مرحلة عمل الهاند رب والهاند ووش، عندنا في دائما تكون عندنا ميست سبوت وين هاند ووشينج، زي ما هي واضحة في الصورة هنا إنه المناطق الحمراء most frequently missed، دائما تكون يعني أكثر المناطق اللي ما يوصلها في حال إنه لم يتم عمل الهاند، لم يتم عمل التكنيك بالشكل الصحيح. الليس فريكوينتلي معطيك إياه باللون الأزرق، النوت ميست دائما اللي هي واضحة اللي هي حين دائما نعملها بعمل سريع كذا، فلازم إن نركز على التكنيك. التكنيك شيء أساسي في خلو اليدين من أي جراثيم. Some of the hand surface could be missed when not using the right hand washing technique، عندما لم يتم عملها بالشكل الصحيح. عندنا طبعا هذه زي ما أنتم شايفينها جميع هذه البوسترز موجودة في جميع المراكز المنشآت الصحية. طبعا الهاند ووش والهاند روب تتكلم كل واحدة عن تكنيك محدد. طبعا نفس التكنيك، لكن عندنا في فرق بين الهاند روب والهاند ووش. الهاند ووش عندنا في البداية لازم انه يتم ترطيب الأيدي في البداية، بعدها يتم عمل applying للسوب عشان يكون في cover للall hand surface، بعدها rub the hands palm to palm، بعدها right palm over a lift with infected fingers، تكون موضوعة من الفوق، بعدها تشبيك الأصابع من الداخل، أيضا بعدها تشبيك الأربع أصابع مع الأربع أصابع حقت الأيدي، بعدها الإصبع الخامس يتم عمله في المرحلة السادسة، في المرحلة السابعة يتم عمل الأصابع داخل اليدين، في المرحلة اللي بعدها غسيل الأيدي، بعدها يتم dry الهاندز في تمسيحها بالمناديل، بعدها يتم اقفال الصنبور، بعدها تكون اليد جاهزه. هذه بالنسبه للهاند ووش. بالنسبه للهاند روب على طول التكنيك نفسها بالكامل كما هي موضحه في الصوره. عندنا لازم نعرف انه متى يكون افكتيف، متى تكون الهاند فعاله ما فيها خاليه من اي من الجراثيم، عندما يتم عمل التكنيك بشكل صحيح، عندما تكون الماتيريالز المستخدمه نفس الماتيريالز المطابقة للمواصفات والمقاييس. عندنا أيضا عندما يكون الوقت، استخدام الوقت كما هو موضح اللي هو من 20 إلى 30 ثانية بالنسبة للهاند روبينج، بالنسبة للهاند ووشينج من 40 إلى 60 ثانية. طيب عندنا هنا the purpose of observing hand hygiene is to determine a degree of compliance with hand hygiene practices by healthcare worker. إيش النتائج أو results of this observation عشان تساعد to identify the most appropriate intervention for hand hygiene promotions, education and training. عندنا هنا هذه زي ما انتم شايفين الـ Guide to Implementation للـ WHO، A regular presentation including induction of new staff، الـ e-learning، self-learning models، الـ posters اللي تكون موجودة، الـ focus group، الـ reflective discussion، video practical demonstration، الـ feedback from assessment، البودي سيستم. عندنا ايضا حاجه تسمى بالمالتي مودل. المالتي مودل استراتيجي هي نفسها هي عباره عن مرحله تطويره لبرنامج الهاند هايجين داخل المنشاه الصحيه. عندنا في حاجه تسمى بالسيلف اسسمنت تعمل داخل المنشاه الصحيه، سواء تكون شامله للسيستم تشينج، تكون شامله للتريننج والإدوكيشن، تكون شامله للإيفالويشن فيدباك، تكون ايضا للريمايندر ان ذا ورك بليس، اولسو تكون شامله للانستتيوشنال سيفتي كلايمت. هنا احنا نتكلم على خمس مراحل. الخمس مراحل هذه هي نفس الخمس نقاط الموجوده، نفس الخمس نقاط اللي موجوده داخل السيلف اسسمنت حق الهاند هايجين اللي تعمل سنويا، احنا نطلبها من المنشآت الصحيه. طبعا في الان في مرحله الان بما يقارب 30% من المراكز الصحيه تم اندماجها للبرنامج، وقاعده تعمل على برامج السيلف اسسمنت، وقاعده تعمل على برامج البرامج. هذه مرحله المالتي مودل حتكون مرحله قادمه ان شاء الله، حتكون في حال بعد الانتهاء من السيلف اسسمنت حيكون عندك سكور موضح. بعد السكور هذا تقدر تعمل على هذه النقاط للتطوير. طبعا موضحه كامله في الدبليو اتش او، في الموقع الرسمي للدبليو اتش او، في البارت التابع للهاند هايجين. عندنا هنا الاوبورتونيتيز اللي تاخذ. عندنا فيه الاوبورتونيتي اللي هي المومنت وين هاند هايجين اكشن از نيسيسري، ليش، وفيها انديكيشن. هي الانديكيشن هو عباره عن الريزن واي هاند هايجين از نيسيسري ات جيفن مومنت. هذه هي منسق او الكوردينيتور للهاند هايجين هو اللي يعملها، ياتي الممارس الصحي داخل القسم وهو يطبق الفايف مومنتس، يتم حصرها بالكامل، وبعدها تكون في لها عمليه حسابيه عشان تعرف انت نسبه التزام المنشاه الصحيه ببرنامج تطهير الاي تي بين الممارسين الصحيين. عند الهاند هايجين الاكشن ماست كورسبوند تو ايتش اوبورتونيتي، السنجل اور مالتيبل انديكيشنز مي كم توجذر تو كرييت سنجل اوبورتونيتي. ايضا هنا هذه موضحه، طبعا احد البارتات الموضحه هي اللي هي الانديكيشن يؤخذ اذا اتى الممارس الصحي، اذا اتى منسق الهاند هايجين للممارس الصحي يعمل اذا كان اخذها بيفور البيشنت كونتاكت، او انه كان مثلا افتر بيشنت حسب وصوله لها، وهل هو عمل الهاند روب او الهاند ووش. هذه مرحله التقييم عشان مرحله نسبه الالتزام. طبعا هذه نسبه الالتزام كيف احنا نقيسها؟ نقيسها للبرفورمد هاند هايجين اكشن ملتيبايد باي 100% ملتيبايد باي 100 ديفايدد على الريكواير هاند هايجين اكشن اوبورتونيتيز. هنا هذا الموقع الرسمي لاخذ الفرص الخاص بالدراع عن قتل العدوى بوزاره الصحه. هذا جميع المنشات الصحيه مشاركه في هذا البرنامج، تعمل على اضافه الفرص كامله، ويتم اوتوميتد، هي عباره عن اوتوميتد سيستم يتم فيها عمليه الحساب لجميع الفرص اللي يتم اخذها. نجي لل، طبعا هذا الموقع هنا زي ما انتم شايفين، عفوا طبعا الموقع هنا موضح انه اخذ الفرص تتم لكل مرحله توضع فيها فرصه للهاند هايجين يعمل، حتى ايضا الاكشن اليونتس تحسب بالكامل لجميع الشيفت تايم. عندنا 3 شيفتس. بعض المراكز الصحيه عندنا مشاركه في البرنامج وهي تاخذ الفرص وتعملها، وتاخذ اليونتس ايضا، والبروفيشنال كاتيجوري اللي هي مقسمه الى هل هو دكتور، او هل هو نيرس، او اذر هيلث كير وركرز. الانديكيشن طبعا موضحه، الاكشن اذا عمل الممارس الصحي او لا، الجلوفز هل تم بعدها استخدام الجلوفز او لا، الديتا ايضا، ويتم تحميلها للموقع. بعدها يتم عمل النسبه الحسابيه لها، وتاخذ شهريه، وتحسب عمليه نسبه الالتزام المنشاه الصحيه بتطهير الايدي. هنا نتكلم عن انها ليش احنا بعض هنا الدبليو اتش او قال انه ليش بعض الاحيان يكون في مس لهذه، لأنه يعني دائماً المارس الصحي يقول مثلاً often too busy وقت التعامل مع المريض، يقول مثلاً hand hygiene interferes with healthcare workers patient relation, low risk of acquiring infection from patients, a lack of role model from colleague or superior, not thinking about it ولا forget it يعني النسيان أو إنه عندنا هنا فيها اللي هي specificism of about the value of hand hygiene, a disagreement with the recommendations, طبعا a lack of scientific information, skin aeration, gloves use. عندنا ال hand hygiene متى تكون clean hand ومتى يكون في عندنا germ transmission. إذا تم عمل hand hygiene مع gloves هذا يعطينا إنه الهاند كلين. إذا لم يتم إذا غلافس تم لبسها بدو without hand hygiene هذه of course germ transmission. عندنا هنا إيش الأشياء اللي تستخدم الهاند لوشن أو كريم to minimize the occurrence of irritant contact dermatitis associated with hand antiseptics. عندنا it should be compatible with gloves use. طبعا ممنوع منعا باتا wear artificial fingernails or accessories داخل المنشأة الصحية. Keep natural nails tips less than quarter inch long. نهائيا يمنع منعا باتا لبسها وذلك لوصول الجيرمز بسهولة. فيمنع منعا باتا الصدام. عندنا هنا الصور موضحة للديسبنسرز اللي تكون موجودة داخل المنشآت الصحية. Do not add soap to a partially empty soap dispenser. This can lead to bacterial contamination of the soap. دائما لازم تكون مفرغة العلبة عشان يتم إضافتها لإضافة السوب عليها. ما ينفع نضيف على شيء قبل لأنها ممكن يكون في عندنا بكتيريا contamination. عندنا هذه هي السينكس أو المواصفات المعتمدة للسينكس داخل المنشأة الصحية. أنها دائما تكون تاتشليس، تكون ملصقة بالجدار، أنها تكون بدون صنابير لمنع لسهولة يعني غسيل الأيدي. عندنا if you could see the germs you would wash your hands. طبعا دائما حنا نقول إنه إذا أنت شفت يدك أو اطلعت على إنه في جيرمز بتقول أنا بغسل يدي، لكن إذا كنت مثلا على عدم اطلاع أو عدم معرفة إذا كان في جيرمز على اليدين فا أوف كورس إنك يعني ما راح تغسلها. فدائما إنه حنا نحرص إنه دائما يكون غسيل الأيدي تطهير الأيدي شيء أساسي داخل أو داخل المنشأة الصحية وتعاملك مع المريض وبعد المريض. عندنا ريمبر دائما الكحول بيس هاند روب كيلز بكتيريا مور افكتيفلي than soap and water according to CDC. هذه طبعا تقريبا كامله المحاضره، المحاضره جدا بسيطه. اذا في اي اسئله اي استفسارات احنا حاضرين. بالنسبه للمراكز الصحيه هذه عارف المحاضره ان كثير المشاركين من المراكز الصحيه، المراكز الصحية مشاركين معنا في البرنامج. طبعا في حال انه في مراكز ترغب باخذ الفرص وتطبيق منسقين البرنامج يتم التواصل معنا وباذن الله ان شاء الله يتم اضافة المراكز الصحية لذلك. هي فعليا شيء جدا كويس انه نسبة الالتزام تأخذ المنشأة الصحية عشان البراكتسز يكون بالشكل الصحيح، التكنيك يكون عمله بالشكل الصحيح، وايضا انه يتم حساب نسبه التزام الممارسين الصحيين داخل المنشاه، ويتم عمل تطوير ومعرفه ايش الاشكاليات اللي تكون في المنشاه. ما ادري اذا في اي اسئله او اي استفسارات احنا حاضرين. الله يعطيكم العافيه وشكرا لكم.
شكرا نواف، يعطيك العافية، وشكرا على المحاضرة الأكثر من رائعة. إذا في أي سؤال عن محاضرة الهاند هايجين فضلا كتابتها على الشات لو سمحتوا.
السلام عليكم أخت شواب.
في السلام عليكم. في سؤال أستاذ نواف بالنسبة للجل الكحولي، كاتبين هل يغني عن الغسيل بالأيدي؟
أنا قلت لكم إنه هو more effective، لكن قلت لكم إنه في عندنا زي ما رجع لو نرجع للسلايدات، في عندنا 5 أشياء لازم يتم عمل غسيل الأيدي بعدها، اللي هي لو نرجع لها بالسلايدات تكون واضحة أكثر.
كاتبين كم التارجت المطلوب في الداشبورد للمراكز الصحية، هل 40 أو 70؟
هذه عندنا في للمراكز الصحية 40 على اتوقع الان تم عمل حسابها على حسب البيد كاباسيتي، على حسب هذه فيرجع للمنسقه برنامج تطهير الايدي داخل المنطقه، وهو بيوضح له جميع التفاصيل ويحسب له كم نسبه النسبه اللي لازم يعملها بالنسبه للمراكز المشاركين. المراكز الغير مشاركه في حال انهم يرغبون في المشاركه، في منسقين برنامج تطهير أيدي داخل المناطق في مديريات الشؤون الصحية يتم التواصل معهم، وهم اللي هم المسؤولين عن عمل حسابات لهم، هم المسؤولين عن تدريبهم بالشكل الكامل والبدء في البرنامج.
كاتبين سؤال، هل صحيح أن نعمل 5 مرات بالجل الكحولي وبعدها لازم بالصابون؟
ما فهمت السؤال.
يعني هو يقصد هل يتم أن يستخدم عدد المرات 5 مرات يستخدم الجل الكحولي، وبعدها هل يلزم بعد ال5 مرات أن يتم الغسل بالماء والصابون؟
لا لا صحيح، على حسب إذا كانت من ال5 أشياء اللي لازم يعمل فيها غسيل الأيدي يتم غسيل الأيدي، في حال إنه لم يتم في حال إنه لا عمل هذا يعمل التكنيك الصحيح للهاند هايجين للهاند دروبينج وتكون انف. فقط زي ما وضحنا احنا في السلايدات الماضيه انه في 5 أشياء هي اللي يعمل بعدها غسيل ايدي.
ايضا في سؤال، في حال كانت الايد تعرضت لسوائل او بلد، هل القفاز يغني عن الاستخدام او لا؟
معليش اذا تعدين السؤال الله يعافيك.
المقصود انه يعني سؤالها ان هل الجلوفز يغني عن الهاند هايجين وحتى لو كان في تعرض للسوائل؟
لا ما يغني نهائيا، يعني يعمل الهاند هايجين قبل لبس الجلوفز وبعد خلع الجلوفز.
في سؤال، هاند هايجين استراتيجي ناو مدريت فور هوسبيتال از مدريت فور بي اتش سي از ويل.
It's going to be for PHC, not now, because still most of the primary healthcare now they haven't started the self-assessment for their facilities. After they started the hand hygiene self-assessment, it could be possible to start also the multimodal as well.
في سؤال أخير، متى يكون غسل اليدين إلزامي بعد لبس القفازات؟
ما يكون غسل اليدين خلاص بعد لبس الجلوفز، لا 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 يغسل الأيدي، لا تغسل الأيدي.
تمام، يعطيك العافية وشكرا أستاذ نواف على الإلقاء الأكثر من رائع وتفاعل الجمهور معك أو الحضور. الآن بيكون عندكم 10 دقائق بريك وبعدها نرجع بإذن الله. الآن الساعة 8:22، بعد 10 دقائق بإذن الله تقريبا على الساعة 8:32 ترجعون بإذن الله عشان نبدأ محاضرتنا الثالثة مع دكتورة نادين. يعطيكم العافية وشكرا لكم. شكرا أستاذ نواف.
الله يعافيك وشكرا لك أستاذ شواب.
السلام عليكم. الكل موجود، راح نبدأ. Welcome دكتورة. The third session is the personal protective equipment PPE presented by دكتورة نادين. دكتورة نادين برهان who had Bachelor of Medicine and Surgery, Master of Epidemiology and Biostatistics, Master of Biological Science and Member of Surveillance Team in GDIBC in MOH. Welcome, دكتورة. تفضلي دكتورة.
السلام عليكم جميعا. Thank you, Ms. Ashwag, for your presentation and thank you, fellow colleague, our presenters for your lectures and thank you for the participants for your patience and interaction with us. My presentation today is going to be about personal protective equipment or what we call it PPEs أو أدوات الحماية الشخصية. I think personal protective equipment one of the most important lecture in especially in basic infection control because it will go giving us a hint about how to protect ourselves when we are dealing with the patient and how to protect the patients from infection can happen in healthcare. And let's start with the objectives. As objectives of this lecture, I'm hoping to introduce some idea about some definitions. PPE selection according to the isolation-based precaution, and thank you, Dr. Reyes, for your presentation. And this is going to be linked with the isolation-based precaution. Proper usage and a disposable or disposal of PPEs, universal masking, aerosol-generating procedure, nasopharyngeal swabbing, extended use of N95 respirator, reuse of N95 respirators. طيب. First of all, what is personal protective equipment أو ما هي أدوات الحماية؟ دائما نتكلم عن PPEs. So what is PPE? PPE is a specialized clothing or equipment worn by an employee for protection against infectious material. And this definition by Occupational Safety and Health Administration or OSHA. وعادة الأوشا هي منظمة تهتم باعتماد أدوات الحماية. طيب, what kind of PPE that we are using in any healthcare facility, any idea? So sometimes you are using a surgical mask. We saw also gowns, respirators or N95 in a different shapes. Come encounter of face shield or eye goggles. What is the cloth mask and gloves and when we are going to use PAPR or what we call it powered air purifying respirator. So PPE should be used with instruction to be properly used and proper selection of personal protective equipment or PPE is based on two important points, isolation based precaution and the procedure needed for each patient. يعني اختيار أدوات الحماية في الغالب يعتمد على نقطتين هامة. إما اختيار أدوات الحماية عند التعامل مع المرضى بحسب نوع العزل أو بحسب الإجراءات المتوقع التعامل بها مع المريض بغض النظر عن الحالة المرضية أو regardless the infectious status of the patient. طيب. First of all, gloves أو القفازات. Gloves is designed to protect the hands and the type of gloves used depend on the procedure performed. يعني لابد من اختيار القفاز بناء على نوع الإجراء المقدم للمريض سواء كان clean or sterile. يعني أنا أحيانا ممكن أختار القفاز الجراحي المعقم أو أختار القفاز الطبي بناء على الإجراء المتوقع تقديمه إلى المريض. Avoid unnecessarily touching of the environment. For all PPEs, I should wear a PPEs just upon entering the patient room or before giving the patient the designated care, just to prevent contamination of that PPE and لا قدر الله doing a cross contamination and infect the patient أو حتى بعد التعامل مع المريض and even after dealing with the patient I should avoid unnecessary touch of the environment just to make sure not to contaminate the environment. Change gloves if they become torn or heavily contaminated or after leaving the patient zone, and this is also for all kind of PPE, كل أدوات الحماية, if they are heavily contaminated, إذا كانت ملوثة بشكل كبير أو حصل فيها أي خلل أو شق, لابد أن أنا أتخلص منها وأرتدي أدوات حماية أخرى. Remove and discard gloves after each patient. Don't wear the same pair of gloves for the care of more than one patient. Till now, there is no recommendation or no recommendation to reuse or extended use of the gloves. Don't wash gloves for the purpose of reuse, since this practice has been associated with the transmission of pathogens. Change gloves during patient care if the hand moves from contaminated body site, for example, perineal area to clean body site, غالباً أثناء dressing, changing dressing for the patient. So I'm dealing with the heavily contaminated body site, then I'm moving to a clean site. So when I'm changing of gloves is advised in this point. Using gloves don't replace the need of hand hygiene, as Mr. Nawaf mentioned in the previous lecture. Hand hygiene should be performed before and after using of the gloves, of course, after removal. What about eye protection أو أدوات الحماية الواقية للعين أو الوجه? There is two types. إما غطاء الوجه الواقي, face shield, أو eye goggles, أو نظارات الحماية. Personal eye glasses and contact lenses are not considered as eye protection. إذن نظارات الطبية الشخصية لا تعتبر أبداً من أدوات الحماية. Reusable eye protection like goggles must be cleaned and disinfected after every use. Each PPE designated for reuse, the healthcare worker should consider cleaning and disinfection after usage. The front eye protection should not be touched while wearing it, while wearing it by the healthcare worker. If they touch it, they must immediately perform hand hygiene. And we will see this sentence again for a different type of PPE, mainly and part of the any PPE, either face shield, eye goggles, or gown, become heavily contaminated with the patient droplet or secretion or microorganism, لأنها هي اللي في الغالب come in contact with the patient and the patient environment. So healthcare workers should be careful when dealing with the PPE, especially the frontal aspect or size. Note, protocol for extended use or reuse of eye protection should be followed in case of an epidemic or pandemic, or of course, severe shortage of the supplies. And this should be according to MOH approved recommendation and policy inside their healthcare facility. So أي استخدام ممتد أو إعادة استخدام لأي من أدوات الحماية لابد أن يكون بناء على سياسات وإجراءات معتمدة من المنشأة ومستقى من سياسات وإجراءات الإدارة العامة لمكافحة العدوى أو المصادر العلمية يعني المعتمدة. What about the gowns أو الرداء الجراحي? Also, the type of gown depend on the process or procedure performed, either sterile, non-sterile, water-resistant, etc. Wear a clear isolation gown upon entry into the patient room or area. Change the gown if it becomes soiled or torn. Disposable gowns should be discarded after use. The front of the gown should not be touched, مثل الرداء الواقي للوجه أو الفيس شيلد أو الجوجلز. حتى الماسك بعد كده حنشوف إنه all PPE should not be touched from the frontal side. And consider immediately hand hygiene after touch. In case of epidemic or pandemic, gowns should be prioritized where splashes and sprays are anticipated, like aerosol AGP or aerosol generating procedure, ورح نتكلم عنها لاحقا. Dressing, bathing, and showering, transferring the patient, يعني لابد في حالات الجوائح والنقص الشديد في أدوات الحماية من الأخذ بعين الاعتبار الأخذ بعين الاعتبار تقسيم الأدوات الحماية حسب الريسك أسسمنت أو حسب معدلات الخطر المتوقعة عند التعامل مع كل مرضى والإجراءات المتوقعة حفاظاً على المخزون. Surgical gowns should be prioritized for surgical and other sterile procedure. وطبعاً بطبيعة الحال الرداء الجراحي المعقم لابد أنه يستخدم أو يكون له الأولوية من التعامل مع المرضى الذين يحتاجون إجراءات مطهرة أو نظيفة like sterile procedure. Consideration can be made to extend the use of isolation gown such that the same gown is worn by the same healthcare worker when interacting with more than one patient known to be infected with the same infectious disease when these patients housed in the same location. يعني في حالات النقص الشديد في الرداء الجراحي من الممكن الاستخدام الممتد للجاون بشرط أنه يتم التعامل مع عدة مرضى مصابين بنفس الميكروب في نفس وحدة الرعاية الصحية. For example, COVID-19 patient resident in the isolation cohort. وطبعاً لابد أي استخدام ممتد أو إعادة استخدام تكون مبنية على سياسات معتمدة في المنشأة. Extended use of gown can be considered only if there are no additional co-infectious diagnoses transmitted by contact. يعني الاستخدام الممتد للرداء الجراحي يؤخذ به في عين الاعتبار إذا ما كان في أي co-infection أو عدوى مصاحبة لمريض آخر. يعني ما ينفع أنا ألبس gown وأتعامل مع مريض for example having a kind of MDRO and another patient having another kind of MDRO وأستخدم نفس الgown. So this is not recommended. الماسك أو الريسبيريتور أو القناع أو الكمام سواء الجراحي أو الريسبيريتور اللي هو عالي الكفاءة في الغالب إحنا نشوف عدة أنواع. We can see in this picture, I think this is very, a very nice picture because it allows us to see a different kind of mask. سواء كان الماسك القماشي الكلوث فيس ماسك أو الكمام الجراحي أو الطبي respirator أو الكمام عالي الكفاءة or what we call it N95 or mask with valve or vents أو الماسك أو الكمام المزود بالصمامات. وإيش الفرق بينها؟ Respirators and surgical masks should be removed and discarded after exiting the patient room or care area and closing the door unless implementing extended use or reuse of universal mask. And in respiratory triage, surgical mask is recommended. غالباً الماسك هو نوع من أدوات الحماية المخصصة لحماية المجاري التنفسية or protecting the respiratory tract and the mucous membrane. So what kind of mask we should use, and we will see in the upcoming slides. طيب, mainly we are using the mask when we are dealing a patient with respiratory illness, either the patient having a disease transmitted via droplet روت اور ايربورن. طب ايش الفرق بين المرض المنتقل عبر الرذاذ والمرض المنتقل عبر الهواء؟ ان ايربورن or in droplet precaution, the droplet nuclei is relatively large because it is larger than 5 micron. But while in airborne diseases, the droplet nuclei is very small and it is less than 5 micron. For both diseases, the droplet nuclei or the respiratory nuclei is transmitted from the source or the patient, either by coughing, talking, or sneezing, سواء بالكلام, العطاس, أو الكحة. And we should consider wearing a PPE according to the situation. Here, in, with the droplet precaution, because it is relatively large droplet nuclei, so we just want to contain the droplet. فنلبس surgical mask or medical mask. And if we are doing a aerosol generating procedure, we can use a face shield. لكن في حالة ال... Yeah, and because of this is a relatively large droplet, they are going to settle down by gravity after a safe distance or 1.5 or 2 meters, which is equal to around 6 feet. So عشان كده we should consider التباعد الاجتماعي أو safe distance when you are dealing with the source. While in airborne precaution, we cannot guarantee a safe distance when we are dealing with the patient. So beside putting the patient in isolation room with engineering control, we should wear a powerful respirator أو كمام عالي الكفاءة لحمايتنا من الهواء الملوث المحيط بالمريض. And this is another diagram. Can just show the differences between the relatively larger nuclei in droplet diseases and very small droplet nuclei in airborne. طيب. So as we mentioned, we should wear a powerful respirator that can guarantee a good sealing between the healthcare worker's face and the mask to prevent any infected air to escape into respiratory tract and لا قدر الله يسبب العدوى. And this is a very nice picture from CDC that shows a different type of facial hair, لأنه either small hair follicle cannot guarantee a good sealing between a mask and the healthcare worker skin. So متى من الممكن استخدام الريسبيريتور أو الـ N95 خاصة للرجال؟ وهذه اعتبارات اللحية لكل من الممارسين الصحيين, لأنه من الممارسات الشائعة جدا والخاطئة في الأوساط الصحية أو في المنشآت الصحية هي ارتداء الـ N95 من قبل الرجال الملتحين باعتبار أنه اللحى مثلا غير كاملة. وthis is wrong because either all these shapes can prevent good sealing and لا قدر الله increase the possibility of getting or acquiring infection. So what is the alternative? We are going to talk about it. They have an alternative way to deal with the patient if the patient have or the patient under airborne precaution, and they should use PAPR or powered air purifying respirator. طيب, to ensure a good sealing, we should do what we call it a fit test أو اختبار نفاذية الكمام with the sealing test. And this is a very, very important topic, and it could be a lecture by its own. طيب, what about face cloth أو الكمام القماشي? Cloth face covering are not a PPE. يعني الكمام القماشي لا يعتبر في المنشآت الصحية الصحية من أدوات الحماية. It's not enough and should not be worn for the care of the patient. Healthcare worker can wear face cloth if they were walking in the corridors or if of the hospital or non-clinical area like administrative area, library, cafeteria, where no care of the patient is performed. لكن أنا في الحقيقة ما أفضل أبداً استخدام الفيس كلوث أو الكمام القماشي في المنشآت الصحية. A cloth face covering may be appropriate only for visitors and patients to contain their own droplet, but not for healthcare workers. طيب, what about mask with exhalation valve or vent أو الكمامات المزودة بصمامات؟ CDC do not recommend using mask for source control if they have an exhalation valve or vent. يعني CDC لا توصي أبدا باستخدام الكمامات خاصة محاولة احتواء العدوى للمريض نفسه, خاصة الكمامات اللي تحتوي على صمامات, لأنها they contain a large pore that could allow droplet to escape from the mask because the resistance here is lower than mask without valve. Respirators with exhalation valves should not be used in situation where a sterile field must be maintained. لأنه زي ما ذكرنا أنه ممكن droplet of the patient could contaminate the area. PPE based on isolation precaution. طيب, أنواع precaution زي ما ذكرنا سابقا, either standard precaution, contact, droplet or airborne. Standard precaution PPE should be used according to the need أو حسب ال anticipated procedure. What about PPE for contact precaution? ما هي أدوات الحماية اللازمة عند التعامل مع المريض تحت العزل التلامسي سواء كان مصاب أو حالة مشتبهة؟ PPE لكل المرضى تحت العزل أيا كان نوع العزل لابد أني أنا أرتدي أدوات الحماية سواء كانت الحالة مؤكدة أو مشتبهة. PPE needed are isolation gown and gloves. إذن الأدوات الحماية الهامة عند التعامل مع المرضى تحت العزل التلامسي هي الإيزوليشن جاون أو الرداء الطبي أو الجراحي and gloves والقفازات فقط. هذه هي المهمة, لكن other PPE can be used if needed depend on the exposure risk assessment. Care of suspected or confirmed patient as we mentioned. طيب, what are the examples for PPE should be used with the contact precaution? MRSA or methicillin resistant staph aureus. Any patient with positive for MRSA, we should consider placing him under contact precaution. Patient with VRE or vancomycin resistance enterococci. Any patient with diarrheal disease, scabies, CDF or MDRO. طيب, healthcare workers must wear the PPE while in the patient room and then remove it before leaving the room or the care area. Just before leaving the room, hand hygiene should be performed before and after wearing and removing PPE. So this is very important. في العزل التلامسي المهم هو gown and gloves. We should remove a PPE before leaving the patient room. What about PPE needed for droplet precaution? أو ما هي أدوات الحماية التي لازم استخدامها عند التعامل مع مرضى العزل الرذاذي؟ This is the only needed PPE, surgical mask أو الكمام الطبي أو الجراحي فقط. Other PPE can be used if needed according to the risk of exposure. And of course, we should use it for when we are dealing with a suspected or a confirmed patient. And what are the examples? Influenza, meningitis, mumps, pertussis, plague, MERS-CoV, and COVID-19. And I highlighted them in red because there is a special situation for MERS-CoV and COVID-19, usually we are using زي الحال الآن في الجائحة surgical mask. لكن in a hospitalized patient for MERS and COVID, we should consider also contact precaution because there is a combined some microorganism or some patient should be placed under combined precaution. The important thing here in MERS, COV, and COVID-19 that we should also consider to raise the PPE or the type of precaution according to the patient situation. So if the patient is critically ill, we should also consider placing him under airborne plus contact. يعني الحالة الخاصة عند التعامل مع مرضى متلازمة الشرق الأوسط التنفسية أو مرضى للكوفيد 19 كورونا هي أنه لابد من وضع البيشنت تحت العزل أو تحت إجراءات العزل الرذاذي بالإضافة إلى إجراءات العزل التلامسي. عشان كده إحنا الآن في الجائحة نحرص جداً على تطهير ونظافة الأيدي، تطهير ونظافة الأسطح، لأنه study shows that the area around the patient positive for COVID and COVID-19 is highly contaminated. ولابد أيضاً من الأخذ بعين الاعتبار أنه إذا ساءت حالة المريض ويحتاج دخول إلى عناية مركزة، على سبيل المثال لابد من وضع المريض تحت إجراءات العزل الهوائي. ليش؟ لأنه we consider frequent suctioning, intubation, and a lot of invasive procedures. And also, wear a surgical mask while in patient room and then remove it after leaving the patient care area and consider hand hygiene before and after wearing the PPE. Some, as we mentioned, some infections need to combine more than one type of precaution, like in COVID-19 and MERS-CoV. طيب. What about PPE needed for airborne precaution, أو ما هي أدوات الحماية لابد من ارتدائها عند التعامل مع مرضى العزل الهوائي؟ As we mentioned, the air or the surrounded air around the source or the infected patient is highly contaminated with the small droplet nuclei without guaranteed safe distance. So we should wear a powerful respirator when we are dealing with that patient. وذكرنا إنه لابد من الأخذ بعين الاعتبار من إجراء اختبار نفاذية الكمام أو recent or approved fit test with the ceiling test if the patient have the proper size and type of mask and it is if it is available so fine. لكن إذا بعد إجراء اختبار نفاذية الكمام للأسف ما قدرنا نتوصل إلى المقاس الصحيح للماسك، so التعويض هو استخدام البابر أو الباورد اير بيوريفاينج ريسبيريتور، وأيضا يستخدم في للرجال الملتحين. PPE needed is N95 respirator or paper. إذن في حالات العزل التلامسي الأدوات الحماية اللازمة هي الجاون and gloves. في حالات العزل الرذاذي surgical mask، في حالات العزل الهوائي N95 respirator or PAPR، وبالطبع other PPE if needed depend on exposure risk assessment and we should consider using a PPE when we are dealing with suspected or confirmed cases. And the classical example here is the open pulmonary TB drainage interference with extrapulmonary TB, herpes zoster, varicella zoster, chickenpox, and aerosol generating procedure or AGPs. وهي الإجراءات المثيرة للرذاذ أو الهباء التنفسي المعدي. طيب, this is a picture of fit test. طيب. What is an aerosol generating procedure أو ما هي الإجراءات المثيرة للهباء التنفسي المعدي؟ It's any medical and patient care procedure that result in the production of airborne particles or what we call it aerosol. طيب هي أي إجراءات طبية تعنى بالعناية بالمريض وقد ينتج عنها رذاذ أو هباء تنفسي اللي احنا نسميه ريسول، ولا بد من الأخذ بعين الاعتبار إجراءات العزل الهوائي. طيب زي إيش هذه الإجراءات؟ خاصة في المراكز الصحية، غالبا في المراكز الصحية الإيريسول could be produced in dental clinic، في العيادات الأسنان، لأنهم يستخدموا devices with high speed and a lot of splashes that could contaminate or infect the healthcare worker. طيب هذا المقصود بالإيريسول. This is an example from a dental clinic. So aerosol generating procedure may expose healthcare workers to pathogens causing acute respiratory infections. طيب. What should we wear or what should we consider to use when we are dealing or when we are performing an AGPs? لابد من استخدام respirator or N95 or PAPR. Eye protection, لأنه there is a high possibility of splashes and contamination of face on mucous membrane. Gloves and gown, لأنه the possibility of contamination of the environment is also high. So we should consider using a respirator or N95, PAPR, eye protection, gloves and gown. طيب هذه بعض الأمثلة على الإجراءات اللي تعتبر aerosol generating، ويمكن عملنا هايلايت على بعضها اللي تعتبر من الممكن مصادفتها في الـ PHCs. Endotracheal intubation and extubation, manual ventilation, open suctioning of the airways, cardiopulmonary resuscitation، كل إجراءات الإنعاش القلبي الرئوي أو التعامل مع إفرازات المريضة التنفسية سواء بالشفط، كلها تعتبر من الإجراءات المثيرة للهباء التنفسي. برونكوسكوبي أو التنظير للقصبات الهوائية. Surgery and post-mortem procedure involving a high-speed device. الجراحات أو الإجراءات ما بعد الوفاة أو التشريح التي تتضمن استخدام أدوات عالية السرعة قد تثير الهباء التنفسي المعدي. Some dental procedure، بعض إجراءات الأسنان وليس كل إجراءات الأسنان، like drilling or using of high speed devices، لكن فحص الأسنان العادي لا يعتبر، أو الفم لا يعتبر من aerosol generating procedure. Non-invasive ventilation، غالباً يمكن هذه في المستشفيات أكثر من الـ PHC، like using of BiPAP, CPAP or high flow frequency ventilation. Also nebulizer. Induction of sputum ممكن نصادفها في الـ PHCs، خاصة في يمكن عيادات الأطفال. Tracheostomy procedure. This is mainly في الـ ER والمستشفيات. طيب هذه أحد الـ procedure اللي من الممكن مصادفتها في الـ PHC، وهي تعتبر one of the aerosol generating procedure، اللي هي nasopharyngeal swabbing أو المسحات الأنفية الحلقية الأنفية، وخاصة في يعني كما في السابق في وضع الجائحة خصصت بعض المراكز الصحية كمراكز كورونا، وكانت تستقبل العديد من المرضى أو المشتبه بهم، والعديد من إجراءات النيزوفارينجل سوابينج were done there. Healthcare worker should wear a respirator or PAPR or surgical mask if respirator is not available. Eye protection, خاصة الفيس شيلد if a surgical mask is used, gloves and isolation gown. في ليش اعتبرنا أصلا من البداية النيزوفارينجل سوابينج one of the aerosol generating؟ لأنه when we are dealing with the mucous membrane by introducing the swab, patient can sneeze or have a powerful cough that could infect the healthcare workers. Note, if respirators are limited in number, they should be prioritized for the procedures at higher risk for producing infectious aerosol like intubation. يعني الانتوبيشن معروف انه يصدر منه او ينتج منه aerosol اكثر من من النيزوفارينجيال سواب. سو في حالات النقص الشديد في ادوات الحمايه لابد ايضا من الاخذ بعين الاعتبار نوع البروسيجر and prioritize it according to the risk assessment. طبعا كل الاجراءات او لابد انها تكون مدعمه ب approved policy. Factors influencing a PPE selection, يعني للتلخيص ايش هي العوامل اللي تخلينا نختار نوع ال PPE زي ما ذكرنا. Type of anticipated exposure, الإجراء المتوقع يعني أو الإجراء المتوقع أني أعمله للمريض والخطر الناتج منه. The isolation precaution, إذا كان المريض على أي نوع من أنواع العزل لابد أني أيضا أخذ في عين الاعتبار الـ type of PPE. طيب, and durability and appropriateness of the PPE, زي ما ذكرنا سابقا حسب الإجراء اللي المقدم للمريض لابد أن أنا أختار نوع الـ PPE. For example, the gown, if it is fluid resistant, clean, sterile, disposable, or reusable. This is a table that summarizes all the needed PPE according to the type of precaution, standard precaution as needed, as needed. لهم جميعا ما عدا الريسبيريتور. So respirator should be used only for aerosol generating procedure or if the patient under airborne. For contact, as we mentioned, gloves and gown, droplet precaution, surgical mask, airborne, respirator, or PAPR. طيب, what is the appropriate sequencing of donning and doffing or putting on and removing the PPE? في الغالب أغلب الممارسين الصحيين يرتدوا أدوات الحماية, لكن للأسف البعض قد يصاب بالعدوى. And studies shows that the problem is while doffing or removing أو عند نزع أدوات الحماية, لأنها في الأغلب خلاص تكون ملوثة سواء إفرازات المريض. وممكن إذا نزعت بطريقة خاطئة قد يصاب الممارس الصحي بالعدوى. طيب, هذه جدا طريقة بسيطة الدانينج الـ PPE. أنا لابد أني أحرص أنه أول شيء ألمس بالمريض هو آخر شيء أنا أرتديه, تقليلاً لفرصة إصابة المريض بالعدوى أو نقل العدوى للمريض. فإذا أدوات الحماية أرتديها من الأسفل إلى الأعلى, من الأسفل إلى الأعلى. الأول gown, ثم mask or respirator, ثم goggles or face shield, ثم gloves. So من الأسفل إلى الأعلى. لكن عند نزع أدوات الحماية أتخلص من ال most contaminated PPE first, اللي هو الجلوفز, بعدين أعمل هاند هايجين. طبعاً قبل ما أرتدي أدوات الحماية لابد أن أعمل هاند هايجين. طيب, نرجع تاني للنزع أدوات الحماية, الجلوفز first, then هاند هايجين, بعدين من الأعلى إلى الأسفل goggles or face shield, then gowns, وآخر شيء الماسك. لابد أني أنا أحرص على هذه النقطة عند التعامل مع الماسك. الماسك دائماً أخليه آخر حاجة, لأني أنا لو نزعته بدري أو قبل ما أطلع بكثير من غرفة المريض لسه الهواء حوالين المريض ملوث, فأنا لازم أحرص أنه قبل ما أطلع من غرفة المريض أنزع الماسك. تمام؟ طيب, and if you want this, you can grab your phone and scan the barcode, and this is videos, QR codes from CDC videos for donning and doffing of a PPE. You can take a picture just for the screen, then you can scan the codes. Okay, so this is like a zoom in for removal of the gloves. And I just want to emphasize on this point, while removing the gloves, consider glove to gloves first, glove to glove, يعني ما ألمس الجلد, because this is contaminated. And if I touch my skin, I will contaminate myself. Glove to glove, then pull, contain, بعد كده skin to skin, pull, contain, and discard. What about removal of the gown? As we mentioned, the frontal side of the gown is the heavily contaminated part of the gown, and the inside and the back of the gown is the relatively cleaner side. So I should untie it carefully. أبدا ما أشد العقد وأقطع الجاون, لأنه this could result in aerosol. Carefully, I should remove the gowns. وأعتقد موضحة في الفيديو بطريقة جميلة. Remember that the surgical mask never be used as a face cover by female healthcare workers. خاصة إن شاء الله بعد ما تعدي الجائحة كنا نشوف هذا practice قبل. The surgical mask never to be hanged around the neck or placed in pockets. أبدا ما أحط الماسك المستخدم في جيبي وبعدين أرجع أستخدمه مرة تانية, لأنه زي ما ذكرنا إنه the outer side and frontal side of the mask, this is the heavily contaminated part, and it will contain all the droplet. And يعني حتى بالتنفس, when we are doing breathing, there is like a cycle of positive pressure and negative pressure, and all the dirt will be stuck here. And خاصة هذه الحركة, the frontal side will drop over the neck and chest, and I will infect myself. If a surgical mask is not available, the alternative is a face shield. The front of the mask or a respirator should not be touched while removing by healthcare workers. يعني حركة إني أنا أنزع الماسك بقوة وألمس الجزء الخارجي يعني أبدا غير صحيحة. لا بد إني أنا أنزع الماسك either touching the ties or the rubber band إذا كان مطاطي. طيب what about ال paper or powered air purifying respirator اللي هو يستخدم عوضا عن ال N95 في حال إني ما وجدت المقاس الصحيح أو في حال الرجال الملتحين. الفكرة ككل إنه هي مضخة هواء متصلة بهود أو بقناع, وتحتوي المضخة على هيبا فلتر, بحيث إنه الهواء يدخل إلى الممارس الصحي يتم تنقيته, وبعد كده كل الهواء النظيف هو اللي يروح للممارس الصحي. وطبعاً حسب قاعدة فيزيائية إنه الهواء ينتقل من الضغط العالي إلى الضغط المنخفض, so الهواء هنا هو اللي بالضغط العالي, وكل الهواء الملوث إلى الخارج ما يقدر يوصل للممارس الصحي. طيب الـ universal masking أو الاستخدام الممتد لأدوات الحماية أو الماسك is wearing a surgical mask all the time by all the healthcare workers in their while in their respective clinical care setting. وطبعا هذا الإجراء تم العمل به خلال الجائحة وما زال. What about the N95 respirator? في شقين, سواء الـ extended use أو الـ reuse. الـ extended use هو الاستخدام الممتد, the same respirator for repeated healthcare activities with several patients without removing the respirators between the patient. وأنا أعتقد أنه استخدامه محدود, لأنه عادة الـ N95 يعني صعب في تحمله, مو زي السيرجيكال ماسك, ويمكن يستخدم في عيادات الفرز التنفسي أو عيادات السوابينج أو للممارسين الصحيين العاملين داخل العنايات اللي تعنى بمرضى الكوفيد. لكن الريوز of N95 مقبول يعني للشخص أكثر، مع أنه الإكستندد هو اللي خطر العدوى فيه أقل. He referred to the practice of using the same respirator for multiple encounters with the patient, but removing it, doffing it after each encounter. وطبعاً عدد مرات إعادة الاستخدام للرespirator هي according to manufacturer recommendation، وإذا ما كانت موضحة على الغالب مو أكثر من 5 مرات، و this should be stated in a policy. طيب فين أحفظ الماسك اللي already مستخدم؟ أول شيء لابد أني I label it قبل الاستخدام، يعني باسم أو رقم أو علامة أنه هذا الماسك الخاص بي، ولابد أنه يحفظ في مكان يضمن أنه ما يكون في تكاثر للميكرو أورغانيزم over the mask. يعني ما ينفع أحفظه مثلا في كيس بلاستيكي بحيث أنه الرطوبة تزود نمو الميكرو أورغانيزم، من الأفضل حفظه في paper bag. طيب remember choosing whether to wear glove mask or a protection or gown depend on the type of isolation exposure risk and the procedure being performed and consider the type and size of PPE. طيب and remember we should discard the PPE after usage according to our policy. في الغالب سابقا كان كل PPE لابد انها ترمى في البيوميديكال ويست أو النفايات الطبية الملوثة، لكن كان في عدة مصادر وغايدلاينز مختلفة، وthis is according to your hospital what they will adapt. بعضها ذكرت أنه فقط نرمي الheavily contaminated or heavily soiled PPE in biomedical waste أو بعد التعامل مع المرضى with high epidemiological risk of infection. طيب there is also a very nice tables that show the recommended PPE for healthcare workers according to the hospital area and the type of activity. يعني هم حاطين ال hospital area سواء مثلا respiratory triage OR laboratory and the activity suggested and the type of PPE and you can get it if you scan the code. Okay and I think we okay, all healthcare workers should practice a principle of social distance, respiratory etiquette, and frequent hand hygiene, plus, of course, engineer control to protect themselves and the patient from an infection, and consider social distancing. Wear the same N95 respirators for repeated healthcare worker activities with several patients. I think we mentioned this. And okay, discard respirator contaminated with blood, respiratory or nasal secretions, or any other blood or body fluid. Discard respirator if we are dealing with a patient with a co-infection with the infectious disease. Consider using of disposable face shield if we are using the respirators many times. طيب, the extended use of eye protection is applied to disposable or reusable device. Eye protection should be removed and reprocessed if it become visibly soiled or difficult to see through or if it is damaged. طيب, ولابد من الأخذ أيضا بعين الاعتبار آلية التنظيف. It's mentioned here in detail, لكن القاعدة العامة عند إعادة استخدام أدوات الحماية حسب البوليسي إنه we should consider cleaning first then disinfection. يعني لابد من تنظيف الجوجلز أو الفيس شيلد أول بديترجنت أو ماء وصابون then disinfect it either by alcohol, sodium hypochloride, quaternary ammonium compound. This is according to the manufacturer recommendation. لكن أبداً ما ينفع أني أنا أعمل تطهير قبل التنظيف. القاعدة cleaning then disinfection. And if you want to review also in the same QR code, there is options of temporary measures due to the shortage of personal protective equipment, extended use, reprocessing, or use of alternative PPE. And I think those tables could help you to formulate your policy. This is the main reference of my lecture, the guidelines for rational use of personal protective equipment in healthcare facility, second edition, and it's published by MOH. And I found it very nice if you could just grab your phone also and scan this barcode and to access a video talking about the ICA standards related to PPE, just to evaluate your facility if it is ready to implement the PPE guidelines well or not. And thank you, and I'm ready for any question.
Thank you, Dr. Nadine, for your presentation. It's more excellent and it's a great lecture. شكرا دكتورة. واللي عندي أي سؤال لو سمحت ممكن ترسلونا على الشات. دكتورة بس الله يرضى عليك, هم كتبوا من أول أنهم يبون الباركود السابق اللي أنت عرفتي, I think تبع البيبي.
هذا تبع دونينج ودافينج,
ايه اطلبوه قبل شوي. اللي حاب يصور الكود يصوره. في اي سؤال؟ المركز في سؤال سألوه انه في حال في المركز الصحي إيش البي بي إي المطلوبة عند فحص المريض اللي يلبسها الدكتور؟
زي ما ذكرنا البي بي إي لابد أنها تستخدم according to the need. إذا أنا ما كنت عارفة الحالة أو الانفكشوس status of the patient أو ما كنت عارفة نوع المايكرو أورجانيزم للبيشنت, إذا أنا أتعامل مع المريض حسب الستاندرد بريكوشن او حسب اذا كان هو حاله مشتبهه, واكوردنج للتايب اوف ديزيز اللي انا يعني حاطاه في راسي انا حلبس البي بي اي. سواء مثلا اذا كان المريض with extensive diarrhea or oozing blood or the patient having مثلا bed sores, so I should consider at least wearing a gown and gloves to protect myself, and I consider this patient as a suspected patient of contact disease. لكن إذا مثلا the patient is coughing, sneezing a lot with high fever, so I'm suspecting a respiratory disease. So either droplet or airborne, وحسب حسب ال يعني مثلا إذا إحنا مثلا الآن في الكوفيد pandemic, so common is common يعني. Or if I want to perform aerosol generating procedure, أنا لازم ألبس أدوات الحماية according to the procedures. يعني ما أقدر مثلا أقول في هذا المكان إيش ألبس إلا إذا كانت التقسيمة حسب الجدول اللي أنا عرضته قبل, حسب مثلا وحدة العناية ومن المتوقع إيش هي أدوات الحماية عند التعامل مع المرضى في هذه الوحدة. لكن أنا ما أقدر أجزم بأدوات الحماية فقط بناء على نوع المنشأ.
يعطيك العافية دكتورة. في سؤال آخر وتكرر من عدة من الحضور كذا شخص, how many times should we use the N95, وفي بعضهم كتبوا أنه هل ان كيف نعرف ان هل 5 مرات او اكثر من 5 مرات, يعني هذا سؤالهم.
طيب نفس السؤال. طيب عادة عند الاستخدام الممتد او اعادة الاستخدام لابد اصلا من قبل اني انا كممارس صحي يعني اخطو هذه الخطوة, لابد من انه يكون في بوليسي, والبوليسي هذه غالبا تكون يا اما صادرة او مشاركة على الاقل من الانفكشن كنترول ديبارتمنت, وthey will mention in their policy this according to the manufacturer. يعني كل منشأة نوع البي بي ايز المتوفرة فيها تختلف, وهذا واجب على الانفكشن كنترول there in the facility to read the manufacturer recommendation. وإذا ما كانت المانيفاكتشر recommendation متوفرة غالبا في الجايد لاينز يكتبوا 5 مرات. يعني أنا ما صراحة أنصح الممارس الصحي إنه going to use or extended use or a reuse without a clear and approved policy based on a recommendation or scientific recommendation.
تمام يعطيك العافية دكتورة. في سؤال يقول تقول علما بأن يكتفي بالفحص من مسافة ولا ألمس المريض لأن غرفة العزل في وسط غرفة الطوارئ أن البي بي إي في غرفة العزل يحتاج إلى ارتداء في كوفيد 19 الآن المراكز تستقبل حالات. يعني المقصد من السؤال أنه هل يكتفي أنه إذا كان في مسافة أنه يعني ما يستخدمون البي بي إي أو لا علماً أنها ما تمسك البيشنت أو ما تلمس البيشنت.
والبيشنت هو مثلاً suspected COVID؟
هي كاتبة أنه يحتاج علماً أنه كاتبة أنها في الطوارئ والبي بي إي في غرفة العزل وهو يحتاج ارتداء البي بي قصدها أنه COVID-19 يعني.
طيب المرضى قبل ثم ممرضة الفيجوال ترياج هذه لابد أنها أصلاً ترتدي الماسك وعندها الديسبنسر أوف هاند هيجين وبناء على فرزها والسكور أوف ريسبيراتوري سكور هي راح توجه المرضى أصلاً في الطوارئ إلى غرفة العزل أو إلى فرضاً اليالو أريا أو الريد أريا أو الريد زون أكوردينج تو ذا يعني كل منشأة أو كل مستشفى. فبطبيعة الحال المرضى الموجهين إلى غرف العزل لابد من التعامل معهم as a suspected at least suspected cases of COVID you should wear a PPE according to the policy. لكن إذا ما كان المريض أصلاً suspected for respiratory illness so you should apply standard precaution and you will wear a PPE according to the need. زي ما ذكرنا حسب حالة المريض the patient والله vomiting, oozing, diarrhea. So according to the need and according to the suspected or confirmed type of precaution. لكن في حالات الطوارئ وكوفيد لابد أصلا من الفيجوال ترياج يتم توجيه المريض. وحتى إذا كان المريض with high score من البداية يعني من أحد واجبات الفيجوال ترياج أنهم يزودوا المريض أصلاً بماسك perform hand hygiene for the patient and the relative وعلى طول admit the patient into isolation room.
دكتورة في سؤال آخر يقول هل بالنسبة لاستعمال الممتد للرداء الطبي قصدهم الisolation gown بعيادة الأسنان أعتقد قصدهم مسموح أو غير مسموح؟
في policy للارتداء الممتد أو في recommendation للارتداء أو guidelines للارتداء الممتد للgown وحسب المنشأة إذا كانت المنشأة مطبقة حسب policy فلا بد إنه الinfection control يوضحها ويدرب الممارسين الصحيين عليها و يعني يكون جاري العمل بالارتداء الممتد بالارتداء الممتد للgown according to the policy in their facility. نعم في policy.
تمام يعطيك العافية دكتورة. في سؤال آخر تكرر بطرق مختلفة أن هل عند الاستقبال في المراكز الصحية يوجد reception يستقبلون في المرضى هل يسمح بارتداء الماسك اللي هو الماسك الجراحي أو الـ N95 الريسبيراتري ماسك؟
لا جراحي
الجراحي. تمام يعطيك العافية دكتورة. الآن ننتقل إلى بإذن الله إلى المحاضرة الثانية. يعطيك العافية
الله يعافيكم. شكرا
لك على التقديم الرائع. شكرا لك.
السلام عليكم. مساء
السلام عليكم. وعليكم السلام. بالنسبة للي حين عندنا المحاضرة الثالثة the fourth session it's aseptic technique and safe injection presented by Dr. Nidal who had the bachelor degree in medicine and surgery GCI diploma in infection control and this infection prevention in infection prevention control infection prevention control and administration Jeddah region medicine of health. حياك دكتور وتفضل.
السلام عليكم مساء الخير. انضال تشكندي معاكم. Today ان شاء الله I will talk about aseptic technique and safe handling of sharps. I will start with aseptic technique. Maybe you are not using the aseptic technique that much in primary healthcare, but you have so many procedures that you need that technique for. As introduction, a study conducted in 2018 estimated that 1.7 million healthcare-associated infections reported annually with more than 80,000 mortality in the world. Surgical site infections was of 1.2 to 23.6 per 100 surgeries in developing countries. 20% of these infections are preventable, and this is the good news for that. My objective today, I will talk about the definition of aseptic technique, types of aseptic technique, the requirements for proper aseptic technique application, and the breaks in a sterile technique. As a definition of aseptic technique, these are techniques used in practices applicable to all healthcare settings with elimination and or reduction in patients' exposure to microorganisms. Used for any invasive procedure, handling invasive devices, or applying sterile dressing. So it is for all healthcare settings, including primary healthcare centers. There are two types of aseptic technique. The first one is medical or clean technique. As examples for that, medication preparation, peripheral IV insertion, IV or Foley's catheter removal. For the surgical or sterile technique, the second type, as any surgical procedure, and the central line insertion. The requirements, first of all, you need some knowledge for that. As for the procedure, you have to know about the policy, review the guidelines, and you have to know the recommendations according to the manufacturer or even some researches or studies. You have to know about the preparation of the device, the equipment, and how you will apply that technique for those devices. The steps, the orders of the steps is very important. Sometimes you have to start with the first step, don't start with the second one. For the documentation, you have to know about what you should document just for the patient safety and also for the protection of healthcare workers. For example, you have to document the date, time, size, if there is any size for that device, and signs or symptoms if they were at the time of insertion. The skills, you need training as a workshop for the device or the technique itself. You have to practice, you have to watch, then do or apply these techniques, and also monitoring and auditing by the infection control or the quality department to detect any opportunity for improvements. Resources for the devices and instruments. You have to have the device to apply the technique, but you have to review the manual and the recommendation. Personal protective equipments are important for the safety also of the patient and the staff. Antiseptic agents as a skin preparation or hand hygiene or others, even for the surface that you will put some instruments on. You have to know about the type of the agent you will use, how to apply it, and the contact time. You have to prepare the field, especially for sterile field. You might need a sterile drape. You have to have it. You have to know what you will use as a sterile field, and you should never break that field. As improvement project, infection rate, which is related to the patient, you have to know it to improve it. Compliance of the staff who are applying or doing the aseptic technique, they should be monitored, and an improvement project should be done to improve that compliance. And we have to have some opportunities to improve, just to reduce any healthcare associated infections related to those procedures needed aseptic technique. Breaking the sterility usually, or the types of the breaking the sterility, they had two classification. One of them is according to the device or the staff himself, as touching any sterile instrument or device with bare hands or non-sterile gloves, you will break the sterility. Or touching any non-sterile object with a sterile glove, you will break the sterility also. Any wrong technique will break the sterility. Sharp injuries will break the sterility. Walking between two sterile fields, also a cause of breaking the sterility. The other classification was classified according to the time of finding out that if you break the sterility. Like this picture, it is immediately, you will know that you break the sterility as touching a sterile instrument or device with bare hands. It means you broke the sterility already. Some of them, they will find that shortly after breaking the sterility, as touching a non-sterile surface by the sterile device. If you see the forceps here was touching the tray that the nurse is preparing the instruments for. Sometimes you will find that later, especially for those who are working in OR, you will find the gloves was torn and you might touch the patient, but you will find out that later. Unfortunately, many incidents of breaking the sterility will not be found out, especially in OR. The compliance of aseptic technique. A study was applied for 5 months in 2014 for 65 patients and 81 full catheter insertions. They found out that the hand hygiene compliance was 74% before inserting versus 91% after inserting. It was not that low, but it should be higher, especially for the before insertion, the full catheter, and that might break the sterility or the clean procedure that done. 59% of those 81 full catheter insertions were associated with a break in sterile technique. 27% of them was a contamination of the sterile field, 31% contamination of the catheter itself, and 38% a breach of sterile barrier. This means you have so many opportunities to improve in such one clean technique. As a conclusion, applying proper aseptic technique will prevent healthcare associated infections. It might cost few extra minutes, but it will save life and improve the life of the patient. Sometimes you have to do like this for anyone who will not follow the recommendation or will break the sterility. For the second part of the session, I will talk about safe handling of sharps. there was an estimated of 600,000 healthcare personnel that had needle stick injury each year in US. Almost 1 billion costing for the US for the sharp injuries. OSHA estimated 5.6 million healthcare workers are at risk of occupational exposure to bloodborne pathogen or and via needle stick injuries. 56% a chance of dental practitioner that he will have, he or she will have a needle stick injury each year. We have risk of hepatitis B, hepatitis C, and HIV infection if you had a needle stick injury. Almost the cost of diagnosis of a needle stick injury for any infection is 6.5 English pounds. Annually, we have 3 million sharp injuries reported among 35 million healthcare workers. This means around 9% of those healthcare workers are having sharp injuries. There is a risk of 20 kinds of bloodborne pathogens transmission due to sharp injuries. 99% of surgical residents had needle stick injury by their final year. So almost all of them, they will not graduate or finish the program before having a needle stick injury or sharp injury. 37% of hepatitis B, 39% of hepatitis C, and 4.4% of HIV infections in healthcare workers around the world are due to needle stick injury only. We will identify the high-risk groups. We will know the causes of needle stick injury, and we should know how to prevent these incidents. As a high-risk group, it will be divided due to for profession, task or procedure, the devices, and the location or area or department of those incidents. The common causes, maybe this is not so common here, but I think it will be a common, not activating the safety device. If you have a safety device, you have to know how to activate that device just to protect yourself. Recapping is still one of the most common causes of needle stick, and this should stop immediately. Always, always, you will find so many posters saying don't recap. If you have to recap, you should do the one-hand scoop maneuver. Improper disposal is a risk for the user and for his colleagues also. Sometimes the patient will move during the procedure and will cause you to injure yourself or injure the patient himself. Manipulating the needle in the patient is one common reason also. Carrying used syringes and needles is a cause. You should not move with a needle or any sharp in your hand. You should place it on a tray or a kidney dish. For the profession, the most common profession or job category for having needle stick injury are the nurses. Almost 44% of these injuries are nurses. Maybe because they are the major profession in the hospital. They are the most common users of sharps, but still the nurses are at high risk, and they should know that they are at high risk. Followed by junior medical, then senior medical, dentist or dental staff also at high risk. The others, including the housekeeping, lab staff, and other categories. For the procedure, the most common procedure is venipuncture or accessing the vein. Injection administration is one of common cause. Operating or assisting in operation will put you on a risk. And handling clinical waste is one of common cause, and I think it's still here a common cause. Cleaning work area, especially for those who are handling the laundry or dirty linen, they have many incidents of needle stick injury. For the devices, the hollow bore needles are the most common device that causing needle stick injury, around 86%. Half of these injuries are happening during the use of those hollow bore needles, 90% after use but before disposal. So it means that either the staff had moved or carrying the needle with his hand, or the disposal was not improper due to the location of the sharp container. 22% during or after disposal. This is due to either the bad quality of the sharp container, sometimes it is overfilled, the placement of the sharp container was not proper, so the staff couldn't see the opening of that container. Also for the devices, we have solid sharps like blades or needles, but not borrowed. 70% during the use, 15% after use, but before disposal, only 3% during or after disposal. After disposal, most of them, either the housekeeper or the medical waste staff, sometimes the nurses, if they are handling dirty linen. This is a graph showing that though 42% of safety needles or devices were used, 64% they did not activate the needles or the safety of that device. Most of the devices are disposable syringes. Many of them are sutures. The others like lancet, scissors, or razors. Glass also is considered a sharp. Luckily now, most of the glass containers replaced by plastic containers in the lab. The other minor types like vacuum tube with needle, IV stylet, wind steel needle, or scalpel. The location, maybe this is not related to the primary healthcare as operating room is one of the most common areas, emergency room, treatment room, dental clinic, medication preparation, and unfortunately, the laundry is still one of the common areas of those incidents. Another graph showing that the patient room is most common than the OR, emergency room still there. Outpatient clinic is one of those areas. Procedure room and the others. The others including the laundry or the medical waste storage room. Area of the body. Most of the incidents are hitting the hands, usually the left hand more than the right, and the palmar side is more than the dorsum side. And most of these injuries due to recapping. So you should not, or you should never recap any needle. For prevention, you should follow the recommended guidelines, especially for that of never recap. Improved equipment design, and now many companies, they are trying to prevent these incidents by improving the design of the device itself. Many safety devices are in the market now. Effective disposal system, as the quality of the sharp container, the location, the replacement if it is filled, or even before filled, it should be replaced. Employee training for the usage of sharps in general, and specifically if you have introduced any new sharp device, all the staff should be trained on that. If you provide safety devices. Also, the employees should be trained on that. I think lately with the vaccine, a company provided safety needles, but the staff were not trained on that, and we had so many incidents just due to that safety device. Self-recapping procedure, when necessary, you should apply the one-hand scoop technique, as I mentioned. Surveillance program should be covering these incidents just to study that, analyze the data, and try to improve the numbers or the data so you will have less incidents, to see which staff in which area, why was that happened before, during, or after usage. That will help a lot to improve. We used to send data to EpiNet and getting reports. Now I think we stopped, but there is a national program for that. The most important for proper surveillance program is the reporting or notification. 83% of injuries or sharp injuries are preventable. So we should have much less incidents. These are some examples of the safety devices. Safety devices are two types. One is active and one is passive. This is one of the active devices. So once you just push, the string will pull back the needle. You don't have to activate it. Just by doing the regular procedure, it will activate itself. This is another type, but this is passive. The staff should cover the needle or cap the needle by pushing the cap only, but he will not have to or will not be at risk of any stick injury. Another example also for the passive. This is a self-shield. Once you finished, you will push the shield so it will cover the sharp and will not cause any sharp injuries. Some facts that USA annually spending $188.5 million just to handle the sharp injuries. France annually spending around 6 million euros also for the same reason. UK and Wales, they are annually spending around 300 million pounds just to diagnose and do some post-exposure prophylaxis for these injuries. I couldn't find any national numbers, but I think we will save a lot. At least the staff will be safer. After those huge numbers, if you see the one needle will just cost you around 1.5 cents to 8 cents. But the impact of its injury is really high. Safe needle devices, they might cost around 28% more than the standard or regular devices, but it will save you a lot of money and even lives, time, due to the needle stick injury. I hope everybody will be safe. Please don't recap. I'm ready for any question if there is any.
Thank you, Dr. Nidal. وشكرا على تقديمك الرائع يعطيك العافية. فضلا منكم إذا عندكم أي سؤال كتابته على الشات لو سمحتوا. إلى الآن الكل يشكر، ما في أي أسئلة.
في أي سؤال يا أخوان؟ أرجو شرح إجراءات ما بعد الوخز من الإبر. هذا السؤال يا دكتور.
بصراحة الإجراءات كانت جدا يعني طويلة، وفي إجراءات وقت الإصابة وما بعد الإصابة، لكن أهم حاجة إنه يرجعوا للبوليسيال بروسيجر. One of the most common mistakes during the immediate management: don't squeeze, because most of them they are squeezing. Just put it under running water. And the most important one, especially for me, report and notify. So you will be managed properly, and also the infection control of the quality department, they will try to find or improve any mistakes or defects.
في سؤال كاتبة إني is there any statistic rate regarding stick needle injury in Saudi Arabia؟
كانت فيه بس قديمة، وللأسف يعني الإبنت ما كان كل المستشفيات مشاركة فيها. أتوقع الآن المفروض حصن كل البلاغات بتترفع عليها، وأتمنى إنه نلقى شيء من حصن بخصوص النيدل ستيك، لكن ما قدرت ألاقي.
تمام، يعطيك العافية دكتور. أيضا في سؤال آخر، طار السؤال، لحظات دكتور. في سؤال، كيف ترمي الإبر في المراكز الصحية بالطريقة الصحيحة؟ في سؤال كان قبله بس ارتفع، فما أعرف من كثرة الأسئلة.
ما التخلص من الإبر في المراكز الصحية ولا في أي مكان؟ المفروض يكون في الشارك كونتينر. إذا الشارك كونتينر ما هو قريب، المفروض أحطه على كدني ديش ولا تري وأمشي بيها. مو لازم إني أسوي لها ريكابينج بيفور ديسبوزل عشان الخوف إنها مثلا تأذي أحد. المفروض إنه الشارك كونتينر تكون متوفرة. إذا في أي بروسيجر زي ما قلت في الـ preparation في الأسيبتيك تكنيك، one of the preparation also for any procedure that you should have the trolley with the sharp container, so you will dispose immediately the sharp in the sharp container, but never walk around with a knife.
تمام، في سؤال أخليها قديش تحت الموية، وسؤال آخر، هل ممكن استخدام الكحول يكفي بعد الإصابة؟
الكحول ما يكفي بالنسبة للوقت، ما فيش وقت معين، لكن المفروض أنه مكان الإصابة هي غالبا ما حتكون اليد، وغالبا ما زي ما قلنا حيكون اللفت الثم أو اللفت إندكس. المفروض أن الواحد بينزل اليد أو المكان قد ما يقدر، يكون هو أدنى مكان على أساس أنه البلد يخرج بس بطريقة هادية. Once أنه البلد stopped, you will also يعني take off your hand from the running water.
اوكي، يعطيك العافية دكتور. في أي أسئلة أخرى؟ هذا كان آخر سؤال اللي قبل شوية دكتور. يعطيك العافية وشكرا لك، وشكرا على التقديم الرائع. أشكركم جميعا على الإنصات والحضور. وأيضا أتمنى من الجميع أنكم تكونون دخلتوا على البري تيست واختبرتوا الاختبار اللي قبل البرزنتيشن أو البروجرام كامل. ويعطيك العافية، شكرا دكتور نضال، ختامها مسك. يعطيك العافية.